First date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry, this might be new for you, but Ingles has been there before. From flowers to the freshest ingredients, we have everything you need to put your best foot forward.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Remember, you can't get to
last spring with a 3.87 cumulative grade point average while majoring in English. He was named the SAC Football Scholar Athlete of the Year and earned Academic All-America Football First Team Honors. He was also on an Academic All-District selection for both football and track and field. Last spring, he was also named the recipient of the Tusculum President's Award. The Weddington, North Carolina product is Tusculum's all-time leader with 83 career punt returns and was second in punt return yardage. During his 42-game career, he finished with 1,359 receiving yards, which ranks him 15th in Tusculum history. He also competed with both of the Tusculum indoor and outdoor track programs as a sprinter, where he finished 14th in the 100-meter dash and 16th in the 200 meters at the SAC Outdoor Championship. He served in his community, volunteering with the Lunch Buddies program and the Drop Everything and Read program. Altizer also volunteered with the Adopt a Highway program, served as a campus ambassador for the Tusculum President's Society, and was a member of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes and volunteered for the Greenville Boys and Girls Club. Presenting the SAC President's Award to Evan are Tusculum University President, Dr. James Hurley, and South Atlantic Conference Assistant Commissioner, Christian Stryker. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for the SAC President's Award recipient from Tusculum, Evan.
So much of life these days is rushing around from one place to another. Sometimes you just want to enjoy the journey on the way to the destination. And part of what makes it a little more enjoyable is an appreciation for the folks who help you get there. At Ingles, we know that the people who send you on your way are the same ones who keep you coming back.
I think you should take it for a spin.
Are you serious?
Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Tusculum University Athletic Department respectfully asks that you please stand and for everyone to remove their hats for today's invocation and the singing of our national anthem. Presenting today's invocation is Assistant Athletic Director Dom Donald. The national anthem will be performed by Callie Patterson, a senior from McLeansville, North Carolina, and a member of the Tusculum University women's basketball team. And now our invocation.
Let us pray. Well, Heavenly Father, as we gather this day, we thank you for all the blessings you have bestowed upon us. On this homecoming weekend, we welcome back alumni, family, and friends to Tusculum University. As we begin the celebration of Tusculum's 225th anniversary, we ask your continued blessings upon the lives of our graduates as they continue to honor you and inspire those who follow them. Bless and protect all student athletes who compete on this field today. We ask for your healing blessing upon those affected by the recent storms. We also ask that you continue to look over our friends at Chucky Doak High School, their community, as they continue to deal with the tragic loss of last week. Grant healing comfort to them and all their families. We ask for these and all things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you forever and ever. Amen.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and a bright sun through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming.
Ladies and gentlemen, we direct your attention to the home sideline for a special presentation. This morning, three new members of the Tusculum University Sports Hall of Fame were inducted in ceremonies held at the Nice Longer Student Commons. From 2009 to 2013, Bo Cordell accounted for the most prolific passing career in NCAA Division II history. The Cincinnati, Ohio native still owns 15 NCAA records, including 16,265 career passing yards, 1,397 career completions, 2,187 career pass attempts, and 16,432 career total offensive yards. Bo was named the South Atlantic Conference Offensive Player of the Year on two occasions and was a two-time national finalist for the Harlan Hill Trophy which recognizes the NCAA Division II National Player of the Year. He owns 13 sack football records, including career touchdown passes with 112 and 127 touchdowns responsible for. He threw for over 400 yards in 16 games during his career, including six occasions eclipsing the 500-yard plateau. Ladies and gentlemen, Hall of Fame quarterback, Bo Cordell. From 1998 to 2007, Ed Hoffmeyer guided the Tusculum Athletic Department to one of the most successful periods in the history of the university as its athletic director. The Pioneers enjoyed success both on and off the field during his watch, resulting into 15 sack regular season championships, 9 sack tournament titles, and 20 NCAA tournament appearances. During his tenure, the Pioneers were honored with 18 sack Scholar Athletes of the Year awards, 13 Conference Players of the Year, and 15 SAC Freshmen of the Year. Also included are 21 All-Americans and 6 Academic All-Americans. Ladies and gentlemen, Hall of Fame Athletic Director, Ed Hoffmeyer. Lucas Winkleman produced the finest playing career in the history of the Tusculum Men's Tennis Program, and proved to be one of the best all-around student-athletes in the university's rich history. He was named the SAC Men's Tennis Player of the Year on 3 occasions, becoming the first 3-time winner in league history. He finished his collegiate career with a 70-7 singles record and was a 4-time all-SAC performer, including 2012 when he was tabbed the SAC Freshman of the Year. He led the league to the Pioneers to 2 SAC championships, as Tusculum posted a combined 63-22 overall record, including 32-8 in league play, finishing the year with a pair of national rankings. But as impressive as Lucas was on the court, his success in the classroom was more outstanding. He was a 3-time Academic All-American first-team selection, becoming the first Tusculum student-athlete to earn Academic All-American first-team honors on 3 occasions. Ladies and gentlemen, Hall of Fame tennis player, Lucas Winkleman. And how about a round of applause for the Tusculum Sports Hall of Fame class of 2018.
Back hurries. So far this year, his 11 tackles a game lead the conference and ranks 15th nationally, and he had 20 tackles in the contest against Western Carolina, the second most of any Division II player so far this year. Jamarcus Henderson is also a guy who is an all-region selection, Super 2 region selection from a year ago, first-team all-conference. It speaks for itself. He leads Division II and ranks second across 3 divisions in tackle for loss yards for a career at 260. He's second in Division II and third overall with 54.5 tackles for loss, and his 26.5 sacks are third among active Division II players, and that just from the defensive line for Jamarcus Henderson. For Newberry on offense, Markel Castle had a massive game last week with 197 yards, the third-team All-Super 2 region selection from a year ago, and Conference Offensive Player of the Week twice, now three times for his career, for four 100-yard games last year, now tied with Derek Higgins and Kendall Brown coming into the year. Well, now with his 197 yards against LR, the third biggest receiving day in school history, he's moved into second place in career receiving yards and fourth in total receptions. His 75-yard touchdown catch from Greg Rupp last week was the 12th longest pass in school history as the Newberry Wolves fell to LR last week. Now for the Pioneers, defensively, Ivan Hogans has been pacing the Pioneer defensive effort with 45 tackles this year, including a career high 2 weeks ago, 14 against LR. He last week had 11 tackles against Mars Hill. Pioneer defense was strong last week. The emergence of Nelson Lewis has been phenomenal, and C.J. Bartley, a couple of youngsters on that defensive line. Still trying to figure out who will replace Jay Boyd, but last week Malik Goodman was the conference defensive player of the week because of his strip, fumble, and recovery, preventing a Mars Hill potential tying at touchdown score late in the contest. Offensively, we're running the two-headed quarterback system. It's Tommy Pistone, who will get the start, and Alex Ogle, the preseason second team selection. But the running game has been going in full force. Maurice Gamillion had a career game against Limestone with 112 yards and was solid last week with just under 80, and a career high 83 yards rushing for Lorenzo Pratt as he comes through. He's really seeing his first action since the North Greenville contest. Wide receivers emerging. Torrey Ponder had his best day last week against Mars Hill, and A.J. Bellinger has been solid since his sixth reception 78-yard day against the Lenoir Rhine Bears. A player profile look. We'll find out what these two teams will have in store as we get set for kickoff, which is just moments away. We're back with that kickoff as we thank our sponsors as you listen to Pioneer Football for Homecoming 2018 on the Pioneer Sports Network.
Now can you hear me?
Okay, I was getting ready to say Nathan's mic is broken.
Yeah.
Apparently not.
Is it working?
I can hear you.
Okay, Spazboy turned the program to master all the way down last night.
White and Blue Marathon Quick Stop Markets, Greenville Federal Bank,
boy.
Terry's Flooring, Gateway Ford, Lincoln Nissan, Corley's Pharmacy.
Oh, Jake.
We need to put a video up in here.
And the voice of the Pioneers, Ryan Staden. Pioneer Football.
And we welcome you back into Pioneer Field here at the Dicemonger Sports Complex, where the Pioneers have taken the field. Captains are at center field, and the Pioneers have won the toss, and they will elect to defer to the second half. We welcome in Joe Bird to Homecoming 2018, a member of that alumni base here at Tusculum that is back. Had a chance to walk in the parade and be part of the festivities that have gone on here. Of course, a lot of stuff. The inauguration of Dr. James Hurley, the 28th president here at Tusculum, happened last night. Understand was big goings on, you know, here through campus.
It really was. There was a lot going on this week. You mentioned walking in the parade. I actually got to walk with Bo Cordell this morning, Hall of Fame inductee. Of course, we know Bo going way back from his playing days, and so he and I had a good little reunion talking about it. He still listens to us.
Yeah,
he's not listening to us now because I see him walking up the steps there, but but he does. He still keeps up with Pioneer Football by listening to you and I appreciate that.
I learned today that his parents never missed a game. Ever. Not just Tusculum, but I'm talking about, now, you know, you're talking about going some places too at Tusculum. They went to Georgia Southern that one year from Cincinnati. That's a pretty good little trek. So
he and I were actually talking about the Georgia Southern game while we were walking along this morning.
It's a good little track for them. This is a Pioneer football team. We'll take on Newberry today. Always an entertaining game. Of course, it probably doesn't have the same meaning as it did just even 5 years ago, but always an entertaining football game.
It really is. You know, during some of the heydays of this series, Tusculum's big recruiting base was the northern part of South Carolina, the Burns and the Dorman high schools. Newberry has always recruited heavily from its home state, so you had these guys that have played high school football with and against each other, and rivalries, tensions, everything built up, and it just made for some great entertaining football between the Pioneers and the Wolves / back in the Indian days.
Yeah, of course, it always helped when you had a guy that like Zach Willis that brought the energy to every Tusculum Newberry contest.
Zach Willis was we'll just say, an understudy of Frankie DeBusk at Furman during their days there, he always reported. So that was an entertaining aspect to the game.
He never got in that emotionally charged in any other conference game outside of Tusculum. Brandon Glick puts foot to leather, and we're underway. Glad you could be with us. Chance Walker, Deshaun Jennings are back deep, fielded at the 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, and up to the 38-yard line. A parting of the Red Sea at about the 15-yard line, and taking it was Darius Clark right up to the 37, maybe the 38. That's where Newberry will start, first and 10.
Pioneers missed some tackles there and also trying to do some arm tackling. Newberry just able to bounce and move away and get an excellent starting field position for today's game.
So they're going to mark him officially at the 37. We'll call that a 32-yard return. Tusculum was one of the top kickoff return defensive teams in the not only in the conference but in the country, and a big return of 30 yards right there. So let's go first and 10, and it will be Ruff who will start. We'll see two quarterbacks for Newberry today. They'll run a little jet sweep, handoff to Markel Castle, and he'll try to get outside, but D. Alford will have none of that, and it will be a gain of nothing, maybe even a loss on the play as they mark the ball, maybe a half yard. It'll bring up second down.
Newberry perhaps going with a little bit of trickery there to start the game. Markel Castle, the Wolves' leading receiver. So what do they do the first play of the game? They let him run the football.
197 yards receiving last week. Again, talked about that in our player profile just moments ago and where that ranked, you know, in the history, the third biggest receiving day. Of course, we saw the best on this field, 56-49 final for Brandon Bostic, played in the NFL. Jet sweep fake, and this will be rough back to pass, and now he'll swing it out to his man wide open, Keenan Lewis, at the 40, 50, 45, and tripped up at the 41 of Tusculum by Alford, and it's a big gainer. The guy they faked the jet sweep to picks up big yardage into the Pioneer territory at the 41.
You got to give a lot of credit to Newberry's front line there, because they bought the quarterback time trying to sell the downfield pass.
They go quickly, and they'll hand it off. Penalty flag is down. I'm not sure Tusculum got set because they allowed the play to go. It would not have been a false start, but Tusculum may have started in the neutral zone, may not have gotten off the field. Kadeem, not.
Full start.
Yeah, not everyone was set. They can't necessarily call that a false start. Maybe an illegal formation. Either way, it'll be a penalty going against the Newberry Wolves, as on that particular carry was Austin Barnes, the junior out of Central South Carolina.
Well, as you say, Newberry went quickly, went a little bit too quickly, and Wolves backed themselves up first and 15.
From the Pioneer 46, no score, opening drive of the football game. Ruff working out of the gun. Check that. The in-it quarterback is Greg Ruff, the 5'9 sophomore out of Rock Hill, South Carolina. He won two state championships in his last 2 years, his junior and senior year for the state of South Carolina. They'll send Castle in motion. They're going to hand it off to him, and Castle going to try to break a tackle. Gets away from Alford this time, and then Randy Hooks escorts him out of bounds to the Pioneer 44-yard line, so a gain of two. It'll bring up second down and 13.
Long run by Castle, but fortunately for the Pioneers, it was long going east to west and not up and down the field. Newberry still looking at second and long.
Hooks third on the team with 26 tackles this year, and three of them behind the line of scrimmage, a career best, 9 tackles against the Lenoir Bears this year. Was somewhat of a non-factor last week, but his game plan was a little bit different, and that was to shadow someone else who didn't get the ball that much. Ruff looking to pass it, and it's going to be picked by Goodman. No, it'll be incomplete. Goodman was coming, had a beat on the ball as Ruff was moving to the right, and it will be incomplete, and it's third and long.
I think perhaps he might have got the football, but his momentum carried him out of bounds, and that's where he came down, so that's why it didn't hold up as an interception.
The reigning conference defensive player of the week for the Pioneers and Malik Goodman, and I talked about Goodman making that big defensive play, the stop on the run where seemingly Mars Hill was ready to go in and score. That did not happen as he strips the ball from the runner and then recovered the ball as well. Ruff, play action pass, looking, scrambling. He's going to be sacked back at the 50 by Josh Forrest, who just continued to run at the quarterback, brings him down, and it's fourth down.
Great job by Tuscum's defensive front there. They kind of gave up the big play earlier, but now whenever Newberry might have been in that zone of going forward on fourth, surely not now, they're going to bring the punt unit on, and Tuscum will get the football.
So the punt team will come out for the Newberry Wolves. punting it away is going to be Shea Rogers, and this guy has had a tremendous career at Newberry. He's averaging 34.4 yards of punt, net punting yards, which is good. Tusculum comes after it, and Rogers gets away a missile that will hit at the one, check up, and I think it touched the line. Yeah, it did. It just touched the line, but it checked up like a sand wedge, but it had just touched the line. The Pioneers, Leon Cunningham, nearly got the block as Rogers hit the deck, but there was no contact. The Pioneers will have it first and 10 at the 20.
Yeah, I was afraid that might be a situation where you got at least a five-yarder for running into the punter and give you very little bit of breathing room there. But as it was, Pioneers dodged a bullet on both ends of the punt and going to be starting here on the 20-yard line.
Jordan Shippey is back in since he played two series against LR, missed all of last week against Mars Hill. He's the starting running back. Starting quarterback will be Tommy Pistone. Pioneers will go out of a straight eye. Pistone will come under center. Boney is the fullback. A little motion look, and then they hand it off to Shippey. Shippey trying to cut it outside, does, and takes it up to the 27. But behind the play, there will be a penalty flag. And this is something Tusculum cannot do. They have got to win first down all day long, and you can't get caught behind the line with penalties. The least penalized team in the league up until last week, where they were flagged 13 times.
Number 87 on the offense.
So it was right at the line of scrimmage. The holding penalty going to back the Pioneers up 10 yards, going to make it now first and 20 from the 10-yard line.
Yes, that's unfortunate. Tusculum and Newberry scoreless here in this opening quarter of action. Again, the Pioneers last week with the win against Mars Hill, winning at 31-28. Newberry falling to the Lenoir-Rhyne Bears after leading 14-0. They fell 34-21. Shippey, who we've seen this quite often, sees the hole but then trips, and no one tackles him. He just goes down at the 11. It was a huge hole as well. So now it's second down and 19.
Yeah, it's a bad break for the Pioneers. He could have probably at least gotten back the 10 yards for the penalty back up to the original line of scrimmage, but as it is, just to pick up one.
We don't run with our feet under us very often. Let's just say that. So here it is, second down and 19. Pioneers go empty. Deshaun Davis has checked in with Jacob Moss. Bellinger to the near side as well. Ponder to the far side. I believe that's Burnett, who's back after missing the Mars Hill game as well. Pistone to pass and has a man, but tried to throw it through Deshaun Davis off his hands, incomplete. And he was open, but it will fall incomplete, and it bring up third down and 19. Just not a whole lot of plays for this.
No, it looks like the Pioneers actually had a couple of options. I'm not sure if it was Jacob Moss or who it was breaking over the middle there. They can't really pick up these numbers, the greatest in the world. Would have been a better option for Pistone. Just didn't pick him out.
So, third down, 19. Tusculum converting 42% of the time on third downs. Newberry has not allowed but just 10 third down conversions since they're over the last month, over the last four games. They're going to blitz. It's picked up. Pistone's going to throw it deep, and out of bounds was Ponder anyway. He was forced out, but he could not have caught it, and Newberry gets the stop, and the Pioneers will have to punt it away, and we'll see Andrew Cantrell John onto the field.
Well, right now we need a huge punt from Cantrell. Not going to flip the field on this one unless you get a really good bounce and roll, but you've got to do something and pull off a big punt to get the Pioneers' defense some room to work.
So Bobby Irby, the sophomore out of Irmo, South Carolina, will step back to return the punt. Bobby on the year returning punts, averaging 13.4 yards and a long of 47 this season. Cantrell, who is averaging 40.8 yards per punt, gets the snap from Donnelly and gets away a very high, wobbly spiral. Irby will field it at the Pioneer 48-yard line, and that's where Newberry will take over first and 10. Decent punt that time for Cantrell here from Pioneer Field.
Right now, I can truly measure the distance in Division I and Division II football. Watching Tennessee and Auburn a minute ago, Auburn's punter punted out of the end zone. Tennessee had to fair catch it on the 50. Right here, Cantrell punted out of the end zone. Newberry fair caught on the 48. So there's 2 yards difference in Division I and Division II football.
Timeout on the field here from Pioneer Field. We'll take it and step aside. We're back right after this with your score. 10:55 to play in the opening quarter. It is Tusculum 0, Newberry 0 on the Pioneers Sports Network.
The first date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry. This might be new for you, but Ingles has been there before. From flowers to the freshest ingredients, we have everything you need to put your best foot forward.
I'm so sorry.
Remember, you can't get to happily ever after without once upon a time.
Wow, funny running to
Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
It's fine.
So much of life these days is rushing around from one place to another. Sometimes you just want to enjoy the journey on the way to the destination. And part of what makes it a little more enjoyable is an appreciation for the folks who help you get there. At Ingles, we know that the people who send you on your way are the same ones who keep you coming back.
I think you should take it for a spin.
Are you serious?
Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
With the voice of the Pioneers, Brian Staten.
10:55 to play in this opening quarter. Newberry second possession. Tusculum goes three and out, gives it back to the Wolves. No score. So Greg Ruff in at quarterback. Barnes is lined up behind him. Irby, the wideout near side, will go in motion across the formation. They'll fake it to him and give it to Barnes, and Barnes will slip a tackle, and he will take it down to about the Pioneer 47-yard line. So gaining about a yard as the Pioneers stack him up on that defensive front. And coming up off the bottom of that pile, Colton Strickland for Tusculum.
Newberry tried to push up through the middle. Pioneers did a good job closing the holes early, battling off Newberry's offensive front to hold it to a small game.
Devin Woodson also in there on that stop for the Pioneers, and Randy Hooks. So second down and nine. Barnes will line up to the right shoulder of Ruff, who lines up in the gun. Irby is the wideout set to the near side, will go in motion across the formation. Castle is on the line of scrimmage to the right. Ruff to pass, looking, covered up pretty nicely. Ruff now still scrambling, and Ruff is going to be sacked. He's going to lose the football in the process. It's still loose, and it's recovered by Newberry because the Pioneers cannot jump on top of it. Ashton Watson had it in his grasp and couldn't grab it. It's going to bring up third down and long for the Wolves as the Pioneers force a turnover but can't jump on the ball.
Bad break for the Pioneers here. They had two guys bouncing around trying to catch football, just couldn't wrap it up. It hit Rip Crowland. Still, you've got to call that a big defensive win whenever you've now got Newberry backed up third and very long.
22.
Yeah. Still, but I'm sure nice to have that turnover right here on the 40-yard line.
So third down and 22 coming up for the Newberry Wolves. Barnes to the right shoulder of the left-hander Ruff. Ruff to pass. It'll screen to Barnes, and this one won't go for much. He'll get to the 44-yard line of Newberry before he'll be taken down there. So good defensive play. David Johnson along with Ivan Hogans and company, and it'll be a punting situation.
You know, except for a couple plays here where Newberry pulled off the big ones. Tusculum's defense has come into play here. They've got a good game plan so far today against Newberry.
So Chris Matthews in there on that stop as well. D. Alford will step back, and he'll be inside the 15. Rogers a high snap, and the Pioneers bring some pressure, and the ball will hit at the 20 and take a Newberry roll out of bounds at about the 11-yard line, where it'll be first and 10 for Tusculum. So a couple of drives, and we've scrimmaged from the 11-yard line a couple of times already.
And now the offense needs to do a little bit better job than they did last time. Had a couple good positive plays, but the big penalty backed them up, and it was just out with another punt. So try to get a sustained drive here and put some points on the board early in the first quarter.
So no score between Tusculum and Newberry. And the big play on that last possession for the Pioneers was Ruff, who had plenty of time to throw it, but just could not get rid of it. Ruff was sacked for 5 yards. Alford comes up with that forced fumble, and then Barnes was able to fall on top of it as Ashton Watson was unable to get it for the Pioneers. So first and 10 at the 11. Handoff, and this will be Gamillion, who will bounce it outside, and he'll carry it up to about the 15-yard line. Check that. It'll be Jordan Shippey who will carry it and be escorted out of bounds by the Newberry Wolves. Anthony Blue, he and Joe Blue are cousins. Anthony's first season here with Newberry. Second down and 6.
Yeah, pick up about 4 there for the Pioneers. Got a little work to do on second down.
So this Tusculum team wearing the all-orange uniforms with the white helmets and the Pioneer Head logo on one side, numbers on the other, against the Newberry Wolves, who wear the scarlet pants and the white uniform tops with scarlet numbers and the white helmet. Pistone to pass, and this one is going to be intended for Gary Brooklander, and that one will be tipped away. And fortunate, it was just tipped by Anthony Moffitt, the senior from Phenix City, Alabama.
Is this guy streaking?
Yes, he is. And we have a streaker. And it's a Newberry Wolf. It's a guy from Newberry.
He's wearing his shirt and shoulder pads, but nothing on below the waist.
And I'm thinking that there may be a little bit of a concussion situation here for this young man, the defensive lineman out of Bennettsville, South Carolina.
Okay.
Obviously, there is some
There's
type of
something going on with that, yeah.
Pistone to pass. This pass is going to be complete to A.J. Bellinger at the 20, and he'll take it to the 21, and it all depends on the spot. His last lunge will give him the first down. Tackled by David Vereen, the sophomore, but Bellinger fighting for the first, moves the chains, first and 10.
They've moved the down marker, but not now. We finally got the chains going to move along with it. Pioneers' new set of downs has come down about 7.5 minutes left here in the first quarter.
Todd Knight does not like it because he thought that the spot was not to the 11, or pardon me, to the 21, but the nose of the ball is on the 21. 7:20 to play. Pioneers get their first down of the game, and a whistle for a delay of game against the Pioneers. Come on. They were asking for them to reset the play clock, and it never got reset because they never moved the chains. And they were trying to get the chains restarted, and Jerry Odom said, hey, if you guys have this issue, you've got to reset the down and resetting the down and distance. That's the rule.
Good ball.
Oh, that's ridiculous. If the chains don't get set, you reset the play clock. And they held up the play so they could get the chains set. That's on the officials. That's a terrible call.
Yeah, that's a bad break for the Pioneers right there. Trying to get everything going. They had some positive momentum, and then they get held back by a silly penalty like this.
Delay of game penalty. And they haven't even started the 25-second clock now. Oh, that's ridiculous. First and 15 for the Pioneers back at the 16-yard line. Pistone. With Shippy in the backfield, going to hand it off to him. Talking about that third down conversion, Newberry had only allowed 17% conversion rate over the last month on third downs. Matter of fact, 10 of 57 were teams on third downs in that stretch. And so that third down conversion, that's huge. That's baby steps in the game.
Yeah, it is. Right now, Pioneers still have work to do on second down. Shippy gave him credit for maybe a half a foot on that one.
So Alex Ogle is in at quarterback for the Pioneers. Ogle, with Shippy in the backfield, steps up to pass, and as he is throwing it, he is hit, and it will be an incomplete pass. So now third down and 15 for the Pioneers. Of course, Ogle last year completed 56% of his passes on the season, and Ogle also had a pretty impressive game against Newberry, coming from behind with a couple of touchdown tosses.
Ogle was hit just as he released the ball. He was hit. The ball was going forward, but it still had bounced off one of the Newberry players' face mask and onto the ground. Players jumped on it thinking it might have been a fumble, but it was an incomplete forward pass.
Third down, 15 for the Pioneers from their 16-yard line. No score in the game. Empty backfield, Ogle out of the gun. Blitz comes, it's picked up. Henderson applying pressure. Ogle will scramble and just look to get rid of this one. And I think he scrambled a little too soon. It's fourth down, and the Newberry Wolves have forced a punt.
Yeah, he's scrambling backward all the way from the 15-yard line, and he was in the end zone whenever he kind of threw the ball back, at least in the direction of a Pioneer receiver.
So Cantrell, who had a 37-yard punt his first time, punts here at Pioneer Field on a completely immaculate early fall Saturday afternoon here in East Tennessee. Some clouds, but sunshine dominant here today, and no wind. So Donnelly to snap it back to Cantrell, who stands at the one. Irby stands at his own 48-yard line. Cantrell with time to get it away, gets it away. Another high, wobbly spiral, and a fair catch asked for by Irby is fielded at the 40, backed up to the 39-yard line. And it will be first and 10. There is a flag on the play.
ball's probably going to be against Newberry on the receiving team because it's a little bit downfield from a line of scrimmage. So probably some sort of holding against the Wolves.
Our referee is David Williams today.
During the kick, holding number 47 of the receiving team.
Jay Crockett is our umpire, and Brian Chandler, the linesman. I'm getting some mixed signals on that call about the sticks. I guess it means you have 40 seconds when they start it, and they don't have to stop it, and you don't have to wait. The issue was the umpire was holding the snap of the ball. He was not allowing Tusculum to snap the ball.
Whenever the officials are there, they're standing over the ball, and it doesn't matter whether you're ready to go or not, or the game's telling you to go, then you physically can't snap it if he's standing there.
So for Tusculum, then the hold will back up Newberry inside the 30 to the 29. Their worst starting field position so far of this game. And the new quarterback into the contest is the young redshirt freshman for Newberry. And this will be Barnes, who will take it up to about the 31-yard line. Nick Jones is the new quarterback. Dre Harris has seen a lot of time at QB this year as well. Jones just 5 of 8. Completing 63% of his passes with a score is the new quarterback. So Clemens comes up with that stop. It's second down and 8, and Jones, the right-hander, both with the same skill set between Ruff and Jones, but a definitely, pardon the pun, rough start for Greg Ruff of the Newberry Wolves, sacked a couple of times in this one, and he's lost a fumble that was recovered by Newberry. Jones will run the option and kick it out. This will be Barnes at the 35, spins at the 40, and carries up to the 43-yard line for a first down for the Newberry Wolves. Clemens in on another stop for the Pioneers.
It really was a good stop. Clemens having a pretty good day for that young man coming in here. Unfortunately, this time it wasn't right at the line of scrimmage. It was down once they were moving.
So Barnes picks up the first down, 467 rushing yards this year, second in the conference. And a 27-yard shy of matching what he did last year. And this pass by Jones is nearly picked off by Ivan Hogans, who had it in his hands. And the Pioneers twice have had the ball on their hands, actually three times in this game. Goodman along with Watson and now Hogans, but none have been able to be hauled in.
No, not yet. And Hogan's not only top tackler, he has an interception, two pass breakups. He's done really good job in the pass defense.
And the thing is about Tusculum last year, of course, they were the takeaway kings last season, getting very defensive with touchdowns, but they have just been unable to grab the ball this year in the takeaway department. So second down and 10, Jones on a busted play. He's going to make something out of nothing and carry it up to the Newberry 46. David Johnson is there on the stop, and it will be a gain of 2. Second, make that third down and 8.
Well, that was just Jones trying to create something for himself. He realized he was about to be sacked, and he was able to pull away and pick up at least a little bit of positive yardage for the Wolves.
Just a final stat. In 26 games for Coach Jerry Odom, his team has forced 60 turnovers, 12 this year. But he's had a chance to have 3 in this game. Blitz comes on Jones. He'll avoid 1. He'll avoid 2. That's a hole. Holy cow, how do you miss that? Jones goes into a slide at the 40 as Josh Forrest couldn't get off his blocker. He makes that tackle, and how do you miss that call?
I don't know, but Coach Odom very animated out on the field, letting them know that, hey, why don't you pay attention and do your job?
Forrest could not get off the block, so Jones picks up the first third down conversion, and now it's Barnes will carry it from the 40 down to the 36. He'll gain 4. It'll bring up second down and 6. Clemens and Hooks on the stop.
Yeah, Clemens again. Xavier Clemens just making himself here known today.
Gain of 4 on the play. Second down and 6.
That's a big miss on that call for a big third down conversion for the Newberry Wolves. Again, their first of the day, 1 of 3. And now it's second down and 6 at the Pioneer 36. Newberry's had field position all day on the Pioneers. Tusculum has not had field position at all. We're under 4 minutes to play in the quarter, and we have no score. So in motion, Newberry. This will be Barnes again. He'll take it to the 35-yard line. Ivan Hogan steps up and makes this stop, and it will bring up another third down on the play. Third down and about 5.
And Ivan Hogan's just going both sides of the field. He's patrolling all over there. He's made plays on the left side of the ball. He's made plays on the right side of the ball.
Leading tackler for the Pioneers, 45 on the season. So it's third down and 4. They get Barnes an extra yard after he went down at the 35. Newberry is Jones out of the gun. In motion across the formation, Darius Clark. Castle in the slot near side. Jones looks to the right, throws a little dump down screen, and it's through the hands and incomplete to Barnes, and it's fourth down and four for the Wolves in that little gray area where do you go for it, do you kick a long field goal, or do you bring in Rodgers to come and pin them deep again?
Looks like they're bringing on the punt unit once more, trying to go and pin the Pioneers back inside the five if they can.
So Rodgers will come in to attempt the punt. And it will be Rodgers who will line up, standing at his 49-yard line. Alford stands at the 10. Rodgers gets it in the air. Alford asking for the fair catch, and there are two Wolves down there, and they can't keep it out of the end zone. It took a left turn, and they were on the right side of the intersection.
Yeah, these guys, I think two of them were, I don't know if they were running into each other trying to get to the ball to down it, or one thought the other was going to down it. Either way, benefited the Pioneers, and it's going to be back to the 20.
Well, just kind of update you a little bit what's going on in East Tennessee football. SEC football interesting today. Vanderbilt has led much of the game with Florida, but Florida has now taken the lead. But the Tennessee Vols, hello. They need to take 2 weeks off every week.
Yeah, there you go. Under a minute to go, leading 30-17.
2:51 to play here in this opening quarter. No score. Alex Ogle stays in at quarterback for the Pioneers, and the handoff is Shippey, and he just has nowhere to go. Newberry did a good job that time of just blowing up the left side of the Pioneer offensive line, as Broadwater and Herring had nothing there. Actually, that was Maurice Gamillion getting his shot here on this series. So it'll bring up second down and 10.
Running game, not what the Pioneers needed to. At some point, they're going to have to start going to the air and completing passes if they're going to move the ball against this Wolf defense.
But be poised and composed in the pocket. Don't get out of it too early. Ogle, 10 seconds on the play clock. Back to pass, a little three-step drop, a little slant complete to Bellinger at the 30, up to the 32-yard line, taken down immediately as soon as he caught it defensively by David Vereen. But that'll move the chains, first and 10 on a good timing pattern for the Pioneers.
Bellinger, the Pioneers' top receiver so far this year, coming into today's game, 16 catches, for averaging 12.9 yards per catch, and he has two touchdowns.
Ponder will come to the near side, Bellinger to the far side. Mangle and Brooklander will go in motion. Now Mangle to the left, Brooklander to the right. Under center will be Ogle. This will be Gamillion. He'll get the handoff and a nice cut, finding a little daylight as he'll take it up across the 40 to the 41-yard line. And that will bring up a second down and about two for the Pioneers.
One of the Pioneers losing his headgear. It looked like Carter Mangle lost his tight end, so he's going to have to come out for a play.
On that stop for the Newberry Wolves was Alex Smith defensively. From that secondary, he's not been credited with over five tackles so far on the year. Actually, Alex Smith has, 13 tackles, including one for loss, playing in the secondary. Connor Johnston is in, goes in motion. A little delay handoff. This will be Gamillion, fumbles it, but is unable to gather it back up, and now the Pioneers have it. So Gamillion, for the second week in a row, has coughed it up and has been fortunate that an offensive lineman was able to fall on top of it, and recovering that was Caleb LaFleur for the Pioneers. So it fortunately moves the chains for a first and 10 on the fumble.
It could have been a bad break for the Pioneers. As it is, they pick up the first down and move up to the Tusculum 44-yard line.
So first and 10 at the Pioneer 44, 1 minute to play in the first quarter. There is no score in our first quarter. Ogle will adjust Lorenzo Pratt. He'll line up to the left, bring Ponder in motion a little closer to the line of scrimmage. Ogle the pass, completed to Pratt at the 45, and then Pratt is horse-collared out of bounds at about the 47. I say horse-collar. He was just wrapped up around his shoulder pads, and that will bring up second down at about six for the Pioneers. Call it second and seven.
Do have some scoring in the other games. Ryan Carson leads Mars Hill 21-0 in the first quarter, and Lenore has 35 points. 2-3 leads Limestone 35-3 also in the first half of that game.
25 seconds here as the Pioneers scrimmage from their own 47. handed off Pratt, and Pratt will take it into Newberry territory for the first time here early, but just barely across the 50. And that will probably be the last play of the quarter.
It will. 10 seconds left once it gets set, and go into the end of the first.
They're actually going to spot it right at the 50. So that will be the end of the first. It will be third down and about four when we come back to Pioneer Field after this. It's Tusculum.
First date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry, this might be new for you.
Quarter. The Vols are going to pull it off. They're going to defeat Auburn as they are going to recover the onside kick. And we welcome those who have turned over to listen, so we thank you guys for doing that. Here it's been a good one. In the first quarter, we're scoreless, and now Tusculum facing third down and five. A little play-action pass. Ogle is going to throw it deep for Deshaun Davis, and he's overthrown him, but he was held. Torrey Ponder was held. You can see his shoulder pad. It is out of his jersey, and the back judge did throw the flag, so that's good to see, as Ponder would have probably been gone. Ogle went ahead and threw it down the field. That's going to be a first and 10. Newberry can't believe it, but just look at Torrey Ponder's jersey.
Yeah, whenever your shoulder pads are coming out the collar of your shirt, you obviously didn't get that way on your own.
It will be a first down. Juwanza Adams, the first team All-Region, second team All-Conference, Casida Academic All-District, and a member of the SAC Commissioner's Honor Roll. Tied for the team lead in interceptions last year with three, and was second in passes defended. As he continued to be choked up and then a little tickled over the events here today. It's just good stuff. Actually, it's terrible stuff. Bricklander's going to line up as the fullback. Lorenzo Pratt, the tailback. First and 10 from the Newberry 40, and Pratt will win first down, take it to about the 36-yard line of Newberry before he's tackled by Jamarcus Henderson. It will be second down and about six coming up.
Second down and six, Pioneer.
My goodness. I wonder if we had a sensor mode on the video feed. Should have watched that one. That's unbelievable. That's unbelievable. Okay. 14-15 to play, second quarter, second down and six. Ogle comes under center. Pratt stays in the backfield. Bellinger in motion. Ogle to pass, looking near side. He's got a man there. It's Moss, but he missed him. Just a bad throw as Moss was breaking open. He was defended on the play by Kadeem Hines, the junior out of Easley, South Carolina, and Ogle just missing a pretty easy target. It's third down and six for the Pioneers.
Pioneers, they're getting some things going. Not everything's working their way. They're still missing on some of the pass routes, I think. But that they're doing the right thing by trying to go downfield and not just focusing on that run that hasn't been there.
So a Pioneer football team that now faces another third down. They've converted two of those so far in this contest. And penalty flags before we get started thrown by the back judge. All three of them. And there may be too many guys on the field for Newberry. I'm not sure if they got the timeout.
There are 12 Newberry players on the field, so...
There's three guys in the backfield for Newberry, or for the officials.
Substitution infraction on the defense. 5 yard from the previous spot. Third down.
It's not going to quite give the Pioneers first down, but it's going to be third and just really about 1 yard.
So a break for the Pioneers, no question. So instead of third down and six, make it third down and a yard, and the Pioneers will bring in the beef.
And this is a package that's worked well for the Pioneers this year. They're getting those big guys up front, put in maybe some sort of blocking back, and able to get those short yardages and get a new set of downs.
So third down and really less than a yard. Ogle will turn around and hand it off, and the Pioneers, Lorenzo Pratt, will cross the 30 to the 29, and he'll have the first down. And that will move the chains. Joe Blue in there on the stop defensively for Newberry.
Yeah, and that's all you had to do. You didn't have to go for glory on that particular play. You needed a yard to get a fresh set of downs. The Pioneers executed and got what they had to have.
So Tusculum with a first and 10, the longest sustained drive in the game by the Pioneers. No score, 13:40 to play in the opening half. Ogle is under center. Pistone got the start. They'll fake a jet sweep, and they'll hand it off to Pratt, who finds a little daylight across the 25 and down to the 21, taken down by his face mask. And a penalty flag is back at the 28, which probably will be in the area where he broke it, and probably a hold.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a hold against the Pioneers. They had some good blocking. Perhaps it was just a little bit too good.
So unfortunate for the Pioneers.
It's number 72 of the offense.
Yeah, it's holding.
Still first down.
Actually, that wasn't even who I thought they were going to call a holding on. I thought they were going to call a holding on one of the Pioneer receivers who was blocking a little bit farther downfield. Got one of the offensive linemen and backed it up to the, 38?
So it will remain first down, but the ball will be backed up to the 38-yard line. And first down and about 18 to go for Tusculum. Shippey is the running back. He'll have the carry, and he'll be dragged down from behind at the 33-yard line. And there on the stop is Keto Jordan, all-conference performer out of Hopkins, South Carolina.
A little bit of a pickup there for Shippey, but still not having those holes that he needs to hit. Newberry's defensive front, obviously they have picked up on this, and they've game planned for it.
South Carolina Conference football score at halftime. Little Ryan 35, Limestone 3.
So Tusculum and Newberry are scoreless. Second down and 14 for the Pioneers. Ogle, a little play action. He's going to be sacked. Back at the 44, Keto Jordan was not fooled on the little play action fake. And Alex Ogle took a big hit from Jordan. And that will bring up third down and about 22.
Yeah, man, that's a shame because that all last year, and even when we've seen him this year, Ogle does such a good job selling that play action. So clearly Newberry knows what they were looking for on that play.
Yeah, they brought the blitz right into him, and you got your responsibility is to take this. That's how they really burned Newberry last season in that double overtime win. Not today. Pioneers go empty. They need to get to the Newberry 19 for a first down. It's third down and 23, and Ogle to pass. He's got a man beat deep, and this pass is knocked away, looking for Lorenzo Pratt, and a nice job in the secondary by the Newberry Wolves. And back there to break that one up was going to be Devin Cooks. I can't be hit.
It's David Vereen, I believe it was, Brian, at number 25.
Yeah.
Just an excellent job by Vereen, the defensive player for Newberry. He did his job and got a hand up right at the last minute, or the Pioneers might have been celebrating.
Good pass by Ogle. That one, just a better defensive play. You just got to tip your cap sometimes. We'll tip our cap that time to Vereen, who made a nice play. So Cantrell to punt it for the third time. Nose down. And this one will be end over end, and it's really short. It will actually take a Newberry bounce when it hits at the 14 and go to the 15. And there's a flag down right in the area of the potential return. And Tusculum may have impeded Irby's opportunity to return the punt.
I really didn't see. I was watching the ball to see what kind of bounce it was going to do, so I'm not exactly sure what this is going to be.
11:52 to play here in this opening half. Worst starting field position for the moment. Yeah, that's actually the case. We ran right into Irby. Actually, we're being blocked into Irby. So I'm not exactly sure how. They need replay. These guys need replay because he was blocked into the return.
Called kick catch interference. Now it's going to be a 15-yard penalty against Tusculum.
Take it out to the 30. So Newberry will have it first and 10. Their worst starting field position had been the 29. Or is the 29, because this ball spotted at the 30. They did have it at the 15. So Ruff back in at quarterback for Newberry. Give it to Barnes, and Barnes will carry it up to about the 31-yard line. No score here in this opening half of play as we are at 11 minutes and 40 seconds on the clock, and that will be Clemens once again with Randy Hooks on the stop.
You know, for no score between these two teams, Tusculum averages 28.4 points per game, Newberry 21.2 points per game. So for both of these teams to be this far into the game and neither side has put points on the board, that's kind of unusual.
Top two scoring defenses, Tusculum allows 20 points a game, Newberry 16.8. Little end-around jet sweep, and this is going to be read nicely by the Pioneer secondary, and that's going to be Bryce Bartlett. And the play for the wide receiver, Deshaun Kitchens, the freshman out of Aiken, goes for just about 3 yards. So third down and six coming up for Newberry.
It'll be Bryce Bartlett's 21st tackle this season.
Bartlett with a good read, one of that platooning job. He and Isaiah Dunn trying to replace the big shoes voided by All-American Jay Boyd, who is out with an ACL injury. So Ruff, out of the gun, has Barnes and his big frame to his left shoulder. Play action. Ruff to a pass, being chased by Hooks, and he's just going to throw it downfield looking for Castle, who was drifting out of play, made the catch, but was about a yard out of bounds. So it's fourth down, and the Pioneers get the stop as Hooks applies Greg the pressure Ruff to Greg Ruff, and it's fourth down for Newberry.
Another solid performance there by the Pioneer defense. Newberry not making any real hurry to send it out. They're going to send the punt here now.
Shea Rogers has been busy already for the Newberry Wolves. This will be his fourth punt. He's averaged 43 yards per punt in that first quarter.
Number four, D. Alford.
Actually, the average, 43 yards per punt for Shea Rogers. Rogers, right at his average, gets this one away. Alford wants to return it. It's going to actually hit a Newberry gunner and go out of play at the 32-yard line of Tusculum. No return, but the Pioneer offense will have the ball, and who will be coming in? It appears as if it will be Alex Ogle, who will be coming back in to lead this third consecutive series for the Pioneers.
Have a timeout on the field.
So another timeout, the change of possession of the second quarter. We'll take a break and back in 1 minute here to Pioneer Field. 10:23 to play in the second quarter. Tusculum 0, Newberry 0. Tusculum Pioneer football continues after this on the Pioneer Sports Network.
So much of life these days is rushing around from one place to another. Sometimes you just want to enjoy the journey on the way to the destination. And part of what makes it a little more enjoyable is an appreciation for the folks who help you get there. At Ingles, we know that the people who send you on your way are the same ones who keep you coming back.
I think you should take it for a spin. Are you serious?
Ingles, all the ingredients for family. Family.
Food's here!
What's it mean to you?
We got lunch.
To us, it means the people you care about, look out for, and yeah, love. Even if you'd never let them hear you say it.
Hey, you're eating hummus?
What's wrong with hummus?
Here at Ingles, we have everything you need to gather around the table and give each other a hard time. Because that's what families do. Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
Pioneers and the Newberry Wolves were scoreless here in this opening half of play. Always good to see Christian Stryker. You know, when you got somebody coming from the league office, come, you know, make sure everything's good, handing out a presidential award today to Evan Altizer, it's a good day for Tusculum.
It really is. Good to see the folks here visiting on homecoming.
This will be Shippy for nothing. And Joe Blue, actually, they blew those whistles just a little early. Joe almost had that one that come loose from Jordan Shippy. Instead, it's second down and about 10 and a half.
Yeah, that was a good break for the Pioneers there, because if it hadn't have gone with the quick whistle, Newberry very well could have had a turnover right here looking at, you know, right at the goal line.
Newberry, one of the better teams, not only in the conference, but also in the country, and forcing some turnovers. A Pioneer football team that's done a decent job here of late in eliminating that. But then last week against Mars Hill, we had three in this entire second half. So Four possessions, three turnovers in the second half against Mars Hill, but able to win the game 31-28. Second down, about 10 and a half. Ogle out of the gun to pass. Has a man wide open. Deshaun Davis, 45. Davis breaks a tackle at the 50 to the 45 and down to the Newberry 43-yard line before he's finally stopped. First and 10 for the Pioneers.
Biggest play of the day for the Pioneers. Get people excited here. Big play. Roll yourself down into a really flip the field on Newberry.
Jawanza Adams comes up with that stop. His 27th tackle of the year. Second on this day. So, first and 10 for the Pioneers. Joe said it, biggest play of the day for Tusculum. Outside of coming up with that sack on Ruff, forcing a third down and long. First biggest offensive play. Out of the straight eye come the Pioneers. Brooklander, the fullback. Maurice Gamillion, the running back, and just can't get to the hole quick enough, as closing it in a hurry was Kirkland for the Newberry Wolves. So it's going to bring up a second down, and what looked like could have been about four, maybe even three, is second down and seven.
Right, I mean, that was a situation. You put Brooklander in there to block, and he was doing his job. It's just Newberry's coming off those early blocks and putting the pressure on the running backs. Your mother-in-law just got a free T-shirt.
Oh, they made it. Second down and seven. No score, 8.5 to play in this opening half, Tusculum and Newberry. Ogle out of the gun, Bellinger to the near side, Davis in the slot right side, looking right and looking out of the backfield on the wheel route, and Ogle just threw it through Maurice Gamillion, who was open. Just got to throw it through him to him and not through him.
Well, I mean, that might have worked if Gamillion would have been maybe 6-7 inches taller. It was too hard, too high, and now the Pioneers are backed up third and long.
So another third down and log right where Newberry wants you, even though the Pioneers 2 of 5 today on third downs. Newberry did not allow a third down conversion at all against Carson Newman back on September 22nd in the game they won 23-3. And the Pioneers are going to burn a timeout here because they didn't have the right personnel on the field. So the Tusculum Pioneers using their first. Just a reminder for you, each and every Monday during football season, listen to the Pioneer Football Show with Pioneer coach Jerry Odom and our Pioneer Players of the Week. We're live at Applebee's here in Greenville. We review the previous game and preview the next game, and that gets underway Monday nights at 7 o'clock. Come enjoy the benefits of Applebee's and their early week food and drink specials Monday through Thursday, just $6.99. Monday is burger night, Tuesday 99-cent kid meals, and Wednesday and Thursday, wings, just $6.99 all day. That's Applebee's, where you can call ahead or order online. Call 636-1483, go online at applebees.com, order and have it ready when you get there at Carside to go. Join the Pioneer Football Show and at Applebee's, a proud supporter of Tusculum University Athletics. So out of the Pioneer timeout, facing third down and seven. Bunch package to the near side, two wideouts to the far side, and Ogle in an empty backfield lines up in the gun. Pratt is lined up to the right, and now will come in motion across the formation. Fake the jet sweep, blitz comes, pass delivered, and it's going to be incomplete as the pass was intended for someone, but the guy that had the best play to make was Jackson, the sophomore out of Somerville, South Carolina, who knocks the pass away from Davis.
Sean Jackson, that's really pass breakups have not been his thing this year. It's only the second one he's had, but that was a timely one there for the Wolves.
So fourth down, the Pioneers will be back to punt it again. Offense had a premium here on this day. Tusculum have had a couple of opportunities, but penalties have hurt, and then Newberry's defense is really good. Cantrell to punt. Nose down, gets this one away. It's very high. It hits at the 3 and is down at the goal line as Cunningham touches it up just at the 1 yard line. What a punt by Andrew Cantrell.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about this last week, just that family and the punting abilities from the Cantrells. They've got it in their blood and certainly done a good job as Tusculum football players.
So Tusculum and the defense is out. Can they keep the Wolves hemmed in? Wolves are once again a dangerous offense. The self-professed best defense, they talk about that. And so far today, Wolves are proving why they are such a good defense. But Jerry Odom likes to think we're pretty good too. Here's an opportunity to keep Newberry back here. Maybe get some free points or some defensive points. Ruff We'll hand it off. This will be Barnes, and Barnes will do well to get out of the end zone. Back to about the line of scrimmage as Colton Strickland and Chris Matthews combine on the stop. No gain, and maybe a half yard, and it's second down.
Hey, get those defense points. Go after the safety the way this thing's going. 2-0 may hold up for the win.
Yeah. Ruff, who is at quarterback, Nick Jones, saw a series for the Newberry Wolves. Barnes stays in the backfield. They continue to work out of the shotgun. One wide out left, one to the right. Barnes, handoff right up the middle, and he'll take it to the five and take it out to about the 7-yard line. Good surge that time by the offensive line. And it'll bring up a third down and about three for the Wolves.
Looked like the Pioneers might have had him right at the line of scrimmage. But, again, Newberry just keep pushing forward. And now they've got themselves in pretty good position to try to convert this third down and get themselves out of danger.
Markel Castle will line up in the slot to the near side. Always a threat to get the ball anywhere he is on the field. So Ruff with Barnes to his left shoulder out of the gun. We'll move Castle in motion. Fake it to him. Ruff right up the middle for the first down across the 10 and out to about the 16, maybe the 17-yard line before he's tripped up by Hooks. It'll move the chains. First and 10, Newberry with some breathing room.
Pioneer selling out for Castle, perhaps maybe thinking back to that very first offensive play of the game for the Wolves. And as they did, quarterback's able to pull it back, keep it, and pick up the first down.
Newberry does a good job in there. Run, pass, option, offense, and Ruff the architect. But in the passing game today, Tusculum's been able to apply some pressure here so far. Still scoreless, and this will be Barnes. He's met on a run blitz in the backfield, and I think that's Ivan Hogan's. He didn't miss there. He did against Mars Hill, but definitely not there for the team's leading tackler, and he'll come up with his fourth hit behind the line this year.
Yeah, big stop for Ivan Hogan's. Good timing play. Knew where he was going, read it well. And drop Newberry back now, looking at second, about 13.
No score, Tusculum and Newberry, as we go under 6 minutes to play in the second quarter. Ruff out of the gun, deep in their own territory. Send a man in motion. Ruff to pass, stepping up, looking, and is going to be sacked back at the 10-yard line. Ruff did not see Randy Hooks, and Hooks makes the stop back at the 11, and it's third and long.
Randy Hooks, that'll be his fourth tackle for loss, first sack of the year.
So third down. The line to gain will be the Newberry 27-yard line. They're back at the 11. Ruff will move Barnes to his right shoulder, trips to the near side, including Devin Cooks, who is the wideout. Castle in the slot to that near side. Play action pass. Looking, Ruff looking, and he's going to launch it out of bounds. No one over there. But he does get it back across the line of scrimmage. The officials are going to point to a guy, but there is nobody 15 yards out of bounds. And the Pioneers get the stop and force fourth down.
Well, once again, Newberry having to punt. I think, will this be the fifth time of the day?
Fifth time.
So right now, Pioneers, be a good opportunity for a nice return to get yourselves in position to put some points on the board here before halftime.
Well, early in the game, in that first quarter, Tusculum had no field position, scrimmaged twice inside their 15. And now seemingly have flipped the field, but Shea Rogers can change that with one big kick. And no, he's not. He's going to shank this one out of play. Tried to kick it away from Alford, and this one will probably be out about the 30. Oh, they're even going inside the 30 to the 27-yard line, and the Pioneers will have it first and 10.
All right, right here's a golden opportunity for the Pioneers. They've not had all day. Get a sustained drive, put points on the board before halftime.
Shea Rogers came into this contest leading the conference in average at 43.4 yards and has just, well, they just haven't been real good kicks on the day, but Alford hasn't had an opportunity to return one. He had one real good one that checked up, but it just hit the chalk. It'll be Maxwell Joseph time. He had a big day against Newberry last year. It's his first action of the game. And they'll fake it to him. Roll the pocket, and the pass is going to be caught by Carter Mangle inside the 15, down to the 14-yard line. First and 10 for the Pioneers on a pass that was thrown well behind him. But Mangle, the big frame, comes up with the nice agility for the catch for the Pioneers.
Yeah, it was behind him and down low. He had to turn around, come back, and get it off his shoe tops. Roll down, didn't have a chance to get anything after the catch. But still, the Pioneers now in good shape.
The junior out of Bogart, Georgia, from Hocking College, north of Coney High School, has it first and 10 for the Pioneers in the red zone for the first time today. Play action pass. This pass is going to be complete to Johnston at the 10, at the 5, and he's downed at the 2-yard line. Johnston, who had the 2-point conversion for the win last year, nearly gets 6, but is stopped just shy of the pylon. He's officially out at the 1.
All right, good play there by the Pioneers. They're starting to sell this play action, and they're getting gains on it, and moving themselves down now here with opportunity to score.
Being able to gradually flip the field in this one, get the great field position on the poor punt by Shea Rogers, two-time player of the week this year already for the Newberry Wolves. Beef package, and it will be Maxwell Joseph who will go up over the top. They're going to say he scored, but I think he moved early. There is a flag, and the referee didn't blow the whistle and didn't throw the flag till after the ball was snapped, but Joseph got a little antsy and came out of his set. And I'm not sure why they even allowed the play to continue, why the ref didn't blow it early. It's illegal motion. That's why.
Well, right here's what the Pioneers absolutely have to overcome this, because you can't be this close, get backed up because of a silly penalty, and not miss out on an opportunity to open scoring for today.
He gave the sign for an illegal shift instead of illegal motion. Still should have been blown dead.
That's 5 yards either way.
So first down and 6. From the 6, I should say. First and goal for the Pioneers. Maxwell Joseph, who scores, have it wiped off, but he moved. So Ogle comes under center. Mangle comes to the near side. Checking at the line. Bellinger, the lone wideout in the formation. They hand it off to Joseph. Big hole. He'll get to the goal line. Did he get into the end zone? He was at least at the goal line. The Pioneers think he's in. The side judge has to come in and say what's going on. No, they're not going to say he got in. They're going to say it'll be second and goal from inside the 1.
Knows the ball, spotted just on the goal line. Didn't break the plane, they say. So Pioneers are now going to have second down and try to push it in.
On the stop, number 8, Joe Blue, and number 31.
So 3 minutes to play here in this first half, and the Pioneers have it second and goal inside the 1. Ogle will come under center. Boney will line up as the fullback. Brooklander to the right. Ogle now will move him in motion, a little tighter to the line of scrimmage. Give it to Boney, and the fullback will get into the end zone. Touchdown, Pioneers. Touchdown, Will Boney. He'll touch Pater from less than a yard away.
Pioneers doing a good job selling there. They think Newberry thinks Boney's going to be blocking for Maxwell Joseph. Ogle hands off, and we get in and put 6 points on the board.
Will Boney's second touchdown of the season. The senior out of Mayo, Florida. One of these guys that just comes in, the change in coaching staff, he hangs with it, just does his role, and a guy that is just happy to get the ball every once in a while, but likes to be blocking guys as well. Been 29 days since we've had fireworks shoot off, you know what I'm saying? This is the first Saturday home game we've had all year.
Yeah, it's...
Are we taking a timeout on special teams?
Must be.
We didn't have everybody out there. So Nathan Pedaris will come on. I'm not sure if he was supposed to be out there, but he had to find his helmet. I guess he was enjoying the fireworks show here in broad daylight. 2:47 to play here in this opening half, and the Pioneers here on homecoming have given the homecoming crowd the first lead, the first points of the game, for that matter.
Actually, a pretty good homecoming crowd.
Good day today in the Sports Hall of Fame. All-time passing leader here in school history, and Bo Cordell in a first ballot entry to the Hall of Fame. That was a no-brainer. Lucas Winkleman gets an exemption to go in a year early because he'll be leaving the country to go back to be a dentist in his home country of Germany. And Ed Hoffmeyer, the longtime AD, 9-year run here at Tusculum, the most successful run. All three of those gentlemen inserted into the Sports Hall of Fame. The point after by Defada is up and good.
Point by
and we go to a break with your score. 2:47 to play here in this opening half. It's now the Tusculum Pioneers 7 and the Newberry Wolves 0. Pioneer football continues from the Pioneer Sports Complex on the Pioneer Sports Network.
So much of life these days is rushing around from one place to another. Sometimes you just want to enjoy the journey on the way to the destination. And part of what makes it a little more enjoyable is an appreciation for the folks who help you get there. At Ingalls, we know that the people who send you on your way are the same ones who keep you coming back.
I think you should take it for a spin.
Are you serious? Ingalls, all the ingredients for family.
That celebration. Will Boney from a yard away. Four plays, 27 yards, 2:03 off the clock. And one of the big plays, Carter Mangle, helping out his quarterback. Maxwell Joseph seemingly getting into the end zone, but called back for the illegal motion, and the Pioneers still get into the end zone. Glick to kick it away. It's put to Leather. It's fielded at the 5, 10, 15. And downed at the 16-yard line, the Pioneers' best kickoff coverage team in the South Atlantic Conference come up with another big play right there. And that'll be Walker.
Nice. Good
actually,
job.
Actually, that's going to be Quadri Allen.
That's what I was going to say. I was looking, and I could hear over the PA Walker. I was like, that's Allen, I think.
It's first down and 10, Newberry. Offense at a premium here in this one, no question about it. We've combined for 165 yards of offense. Tusculum with 104 through an entire half. And the Newberry Wolves have been held in check. Nick Jones will get his chance at quarterback here for the Wolves with 2:41 left in the half, down 7-0. He'll roll the pocket to the near side, pass complete to Irby at the 20, and roll to the 21-yard line before he'll be taken down there. I think that was Alford. Actually, it's going to be David Johnson. So gain of about 4, maybe 5. It's second down.
Pick up there on the pass, but Pioneers didn't give up anything after the catch. So right now, Newberry's still looking at 2nd and 6.
New running back into the contest is Cartez Cook, who is in the backfield with Nick Jones. Cook will get the handoff running near side, and Ivan Hogans with another big stop at the 21-yard line. It'll bring up third down at about 7 on the play after a loss of a yard.
Ivan Hogans just having a lights-out career and a really good day here so far. He just continues to read the plays very well. We know he's all over the field.
Hogans took a little bit, shouldered some of the blame for some of those touchdowns last week against Mars Hill. They run blitzed him twice, and he missed and whiffed on two of them. And one of them was the fourth down play that went for 42 yards and a score. So a 1:38, clock runs. Jones, little play action pass, looking across the middle. Great ball by D. Alford, who comes up and defends on Irby, knocks it away, incomplete. And it's fourth down. The Pioneers will have 91 seconds, and they receive the second half kick as well.
91 seconds, they still have one timeout in their pocket, so could have a good return here in field position, opportunity to score again.
D. Alford, who second on the team, 31 tackles. Leads the conference with 8 passes defended. Give him 9 now. And that is in the top 20 in the country. Rogers to punt. A little bit of a poor snap, but gets it away in his best punt of the day. Alford drifts back and is going to be hit after asking for the fair catch. And that will be 15 more yards.
Well, didn't get the return, but you're going to get the yards put back up. So that will give the Pioneers the ball and pretty good field position up near the midfield.
A little bit undisciplined. Maybe didn't see that, but it was pretty evident after Shea Rogers just boomed a punt, his best of the day. I would say that he was talked to rather earnestly after his punt that set up the Pioneers in great field position to start that last drive, the scoring drive at the 27.
Let's see. They step this off. Tusculum should have a ball first down at about the 47.
So the 47-yard line, the Pioneers will have it instead of the 32.
1:24 on the clock.
So a Pioneer football team right now leading 7-0. Jordan Shippey, the running back, trips to the far side. Bellinger, Moss, and Davis. I believe it's Fudge, who is the wideout to the near side for the Pioneers. Haven't seen Aaron Fudge sighting in some time. Pass or screen complete to Bellinger. Bellinger will work to get out of bounds at about the 50-yard line, maybe just shy of the 50. So a gain of 2 on that little bubble screen to A.J. Bellinger, and good work by the Newberry defense.
Well, not only was it a bit of a pickup, they also got out of bounds, didn't have to use the timeout. So 1:17 remaining here with the Pioneers in control.
Pioneers with the one timeout remaining. Again, they had to take a timeout on special teams. You know, in that particular situation, DeFada is such a he's such a good kicker. Just take the 5 yards on the delay and save that timeout. But it's just a reaction thing. 1:17 on the clock. Second down and 8 from the Pioneer 49. Ogle with Shippey to his right shoulder. Looking, lobbing it to no one. Incomplete. Good coverage by the Newberry Wolves, as I guess it was intended for Bellinger. And Bellinger may have run the wrong route there and stopped the route, and Ogle was anticipating him going somewhere else.
Now, here's where the Pioneers have to be very careful. They really need to get a first down. If they turn it over on downs here, Newberry will have the ball with about a minute to go and all three of their timeouts.
So third down with a minute 16 to play here in this opening half, Tusculum leading 7-0. Aaron Fudge will line up as the single wideout near side. Two wideouts to the far side, and Brooklander, the tight end, to the right as well. This will be Pratt, delay. He'll have it at the 46-yard line, maybe, and stopped there by Joe Blue, who's so active defensively, just like Ivan Hogan's. And it will be fourth down, and Todd Knight's going to allow the clock to run. We go inside of a minute to play. The Pioneers can take this thing down to about 35 seconds before they have to snap it.
I'm really surprised here, because it looked to me like Newberry was going to try to call timeout, and then it changed their minds, decided not to do it. So the Pioneers will have to punt the football.
Right now they have the offense staying out there on 4th and 4 from the Newberry 46-yard line. And Ogle really just standing over staring at his offensive coordinator, and Jerry Odom will burn their final timeout. So 33 seconds on the clock. And you would have to imagine that Cantrell will go ahead and come out with your team leading 7-0, and your defense so far in control against the Newberry Wolves offense.
Yeah, I mean, that's a smart play. It's 4th and 4. It is manageable, but you don't want to have to risk it right now whenever you're just nursing a 7-0 lead, and you've more or less got the momentum this close to halftime.
Don't forget to join us on Monday for the Pioneer Football Show. That's our radio show right here on the Pioneer Sports Network, 95.5 FM, AM 1450 around the world through Jewel95.5.com, also through TusculumPioneers.com, and the Pioneer Football TV show, which will air on the Pioneer YouTube channel. You can check that out Tuesday evenings with Pioneer coach Jerry Odom, a recap of this game and a preview of Tusculum's road contest next Saturday when we travel to Salisbury, North Carolina to take on Catawba for a 1:30 start. Rest of the year will be a 1:30 start, with the exception, I believe, of Wingate, unless they have changed that time. Right now it's listed at 1:30, at least on my schedule, but that was originally a 3 o'clock start, but I'm not sure if they've changed
it. Well, common sense dictates that, well, first, we shouldn't play Wingate on the last game of the year, but second, if we do, it needs to be at 1:30.
Cantrell is in to punt it away, and he's had a nice day. He pinned Newberry in on his last punt at the 1 because of Leon Cunningham getting down the field. So Cantrell, this time just a straight-on, nose-up punt, and this one will be just kick it as far as I can, does, and it will go into the end zone for a touchback, no return. Newberry will have it 1st and 10 at the 20. They have their full complement of timeouts at 24 seconds left in the first half.
And that's why I'm surprised that Newberry didn't use one of those timeouts earlier, because they would have had close to a minute, like closer than they are now. Maybe an opportunity to do something. So you just kind of wonder, maybe they're going to take one or two looks downfield and then ride this thing on into the break.
Jones remains the quarterback for Newberry. And in the backfield for the Wolves is going to be Barnes. Two wideouts come to the near side, Keenan Lewis and Castle, and two wideouts to the far side. Jones, who's 5 of 8 passing on the year, will hand it off to Barnes. Barnes will break a couple of tackles, stay in bounds across the 25 up to the 28, and brought down by Josh Forrest and company. And the clock will run, and we will go to the locker room here at the half with the Pioneers leading 7-0. And receiving the second half kickoff. Jones is going to try to work to get off one more play. But it's not going to happen. That's the end of the half. Yeah, there we go. Good grief. So at the end of the first half, the Tusculum Pioneers will go to the locker room. And really just thanks to their defense and just being patient and just kind of chipping away, they didn't have field position in the first quarter. They worked to get field position in the second quarter, and thanks to a bad punt, took a relatively short drive into the end zone.
Yeah, they did. So field position is probably going to be the main topic of conversation for both teams as they go into the locker rooms.
The Pioneers go to the break, leading the Wolves in the team's 21st meeting all time. Coming up at the half, a look at this week in Tusculum Athletics, your first half stats and your first half highlights, and that's when we come back here from Pioneer Field.
The first date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry, this might be new for you, but Ingles has been there before. From flowers to the freshest ingredients, we have everything you need to put your best foot forward.
I'm so sorry.
Remember, you can't get to happily ever after without once upon a time. Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the presentation of your 2018 Tusculum University Homecoming Court, representing the freshman class, Miss Grace Rowe. A freshman from Mohawk, Tennessee, Grace is the daughter of David and Jennifer Rowe. Mr. Marcus Savage, a freshman from Latrell, Tennessee, Marcus is the son of Ladiana and Dwight Savage. Miss Courtney Padgett. Courtney, a freshman from Orange County, Virginia. She is the daughter of Jennifer and Travis Padgett. And Mr. Deshaun Slappy, a freshman from Clarksville, Tennessee. Deshaun is the son of Demisha MacArthur. Representing the sophomore class, Miss Emily Peitzik, a sophomore from Alcoa, Tennessee. She is the daughter of Brian and Karen Peitzik. Mr. Jackson Richards, a sophomore from Alcoa, Tennessee. He is the son of Christy and John Richards. Ms. Carmen Dasani. Carmen is a sophomore from Chicago, Illinois. She is the daughter of Robert and Christy Dasani. Mr. Andrew Fowler, a sophomore from Hillsdale, Michigan, the son of Greg and Crystal Fowler. Representing the junior class, Miss Emma McHouston, a junior from Chattanooga, Tennessee, the daughter of Jean and Scott McHouston. Mr. Andre Jones, a junior from High Point, North Carolina, the son of Demetrius Jones and Robert Porche. Ms. Tara Shields, a junior from Maryville, Tennessee, the daughter of Trent and Terry Shields. Mr. Kevion Broadwater, a junior from North Augusta, South Carolina, the son of Kenda and Robert Broadwater. And representing the senior class, Ms. Taylor Berryhill, a senior athletic training and pre-physical training major from Murfreesboro, Tennessee. Taylor is an orientation leader, a religion tutor, a member of the President's Society, and a member of the Athletic Training Student Society. Taylor's future plans include receiving her board certification to work as an athletic trainer at a high school and applying to a doctorate of physical therapy program. Taylor is the daughter of Doug and Amy Berryhill. Mr. John Bivens. John is a senior psychology major and religion minor from Hendersonville, North Carolina. John is a small group leader for the Gathering Ministry and helps with the CYA ministry on campus. John's future plans include attending Liberty University to begin his Master's of Divinity with a focus on leadership. John is the son of Marcy Wilson and Tony Bivens. Ms. Erica Garrett, a senior business management and business entrepreneurship double major from Gadsden, Alabama. De Erica is a member of the Tusculum Spirit Squad, Tusculum Activities Board, Honors Program, President's Society, Student Support Services, and Tutoring Program. De Erica also serves as a mentor, the president of the TU Business Association, and the vice president of the Student Government Association. De Erica's future plans include attending graduate school for sports management. De Erica is the daughter of Regina Garrett. Mr. Charlie Mills, a senior accounting and management major from Hamburg, New Jersey. Charlie is a member of the men's lacrosse team and a resident assistant on campus. Charlie's future plans include retiring from being the men's lacrosse team dad, beginning a career in financial planning, traveling the world, buying a few puppies, and starting a family. He would also like to convince Jordan Burke that gravy is not called sauce. Charlie is the son of Rich and Lisa Mills. Miss Amber Loggins. Amber is a special education major from Huntington, Tennessee. She's an orientation leader, a mentor for student support services, a resident assistant, an English tutor, a member of President's Society, and the treasurer of the Education Club. Amber's future plans include attending graduate school and teaching in her hometown. Amber is the daughter of Joe and Denise Loggins. Mr. Christian Sisto. Christian is a senior sports manager and sports science double major and coaching minor from Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. Christian is a thrower for the men's track and field team, a member of student sports services, and an orientation leader. Christian's future plans include attending a master's program in sports administration. Christian is the son of Anthony and Tracy Sisto. Ms. Taylor Battle. Taylor is a senior biology and pre-physical therapy major from Chattanooga, Tennessee. Taylor is a four-year member of the Tusculum softball team and a member of the Alpha Chi Honor Society. Taylor's future plans include attending graduate school for physical therapy, traveling the world to practice in her field, and opening up her own practice. Taylor is the daughter of Dorothy Taylor and Michael Battle. And Mr. Ashton Watson, a senior psychology behavioral health major from Ooltewah, Tennessee. Ashton is a member of the Tusculum football team, the chairman of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, and a member of the Gene Maddox Multicultural Association. Ashton's future plans include attending graduate school or seminary school and achieving his doctorate. Ashton is the son of Melissa Love and Willie Watson. And now to announce the junior class prince and princess. The junior class prince is Andre Jones. And the junior class princess is Emma McHouston. And now, for the moment we've all been waiting for, the crowning of the 2018 Homecoming King and Queen. Crowning this year's King and Queen are President and Mrs. Hurley. The 2018 Homecoming King is Christian Sisto. And joining Christian in royalty, the 2018 Homecoming Queen is Taylor Battle. Ladies and gentlemen, how about a big round of applause to this year's Homecoming Court representatives?
Nice to finally have these tennis courts and not have to drive to the tennis center all the time. And thank you to all the donors that made these courts possible.
Hi, I'm Amber Lackey and I'm playing on the tennis courts right now. Whenever I play on them, I feel like I have superpowers. They're a great addition to our tennis season this year, and I'm excited to see where it takes us.
We're just super excited to be on the courts finally, and it's been a fun process obviously to watch all the construction taking place and the excitement's been building, and it's just nice to be giving our student athletes exactly what they deserve. I think it's going to be the nicest facility in the conference, and I think that, you know, the excitement has just been building on campus for the last couple of years, and I think for our program as a whole, this is just a great, you know, tangible statement of, hey, this is the direction we're going. We're trying to, you know, become the best team in this conference, one of the best teams in this region, one of the best teams in the nation, and I think that we're providing our players with the opportunity to become just that now, you know. It's great to see the Nichols Tennis Complex get a facelift to honor that family and, you know, our two donors who helped us do this. It just shows you how far the reach of Pioneer Nation goes, and we're super grateful to them and excited to start winning matches out here.
We're honored by being named the South Atlanta Conference Scholar Athlete for their respective sports. Katie Tomasoni, a senior from Mason, Ohio, was named the SAC Women's Golf Scholar Athlete of the Year. She has a 3.76 cumulative grade point average while majoring in sports management. Katie is a three-time All-Conference selection and has been named the WGCA All-America Scholar Team on three occasions. She has the third lowest scoring average in school history and has won three tournament medals, including the Dibble Classic this past fall. She is active in the community and is serving as Vice President of the Pioneer Student Athlete Advisory Committee. Francisca Fuque, a 2018 Tusculum graduate, was named the 2018 SAC Women's Tennis Scholar Athlete of the Year. She finished with an impressive 3.99 GPA while majoring in management and economics. She is a four-time All-Conference performer, leading the Pioneers to a pair of NCAA tournament appearances and a SAC tournament title. Her 69 singles victories are the most in program history and was a three-time all-conference standout in doubles. She finished as a three-time academic All-America and a four-time ITA Scholar Athlete. Fans, please join me in congratulating Katie Tomasoni and Francisca Funke, our spring South Atlantic Conference Scholar Athletes of the Year.
It's fine. It'll be okay, okay? Nobody cares about the flowers. Who needs flowers at a wedding?
At Ingles, we know that the best of plans don't always go according to plan.
My best friend's getting married today and the florist never showed.
That's why we're always there when you need us.
What are their colors?
Purple and cream.
With smiling faces and helping hands.
No one cares. No one cares. You will look great. Flowers are not important. And where is Holly? Have anyone seen Holly?
And although life will be predictably unpredictable,
let's get you to that wedding.
A curveball is that much more satisfying.
I got the flowers!
When you knock it out of the park.
Oh my gosh, it's awesome!
So when the plan goes out the window and improvisation becomes the order of the day, just remember, that's where the best of memories are made.
All right, they're ready for us.
True story. Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
There's one thing you can never have sex without.
It's not something you buy.
In fact, there's only one way to get it.
It has to be given to you, freely.
And without it, you can't have sex.
And neither can I. It's consent.
Because sex without it isn't sex.
It's rape.
Consent. If you don't get it, you don't get it.
It's on us.
It's on us.
It's on us.
It's on us.
It's on us. It's on all of us.
It's on us to stop sexual assault. Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org. So much of life these days is rushing around from one place to another. Sometimes you just want to enjoy the journey on the way to the destination. And part of what makes it a little more enjoyable is an appreciation for the folks who help you get there. At Ingles, we know that the people who send you on your way are the same ones who keep you coming back.
I think you should take it for a spin.
Are you serious? Ingles, all the ingredients for family. Family.
Food's here!
What's it mean to you?
You got lunch.
To us, it means the people you care about, look out for, and yeah, love. Even if you'd never let them hear you say it.
Hey, you're eating hummus?
What's wrong with hummus?
Here at Ingles, we have everything you need to gather around the table and give each other a hard time. Because that's what families do. Ingles, all the ingredients for
Thank you.
quarter. The Bears lead that game 49-3. And Carson Newman also at home, homecoming down on Mossy Creek. Hate you missed that one, Brian. Carson Newman leads Mars Hill 35-7, and that is late in the second quarter.
I've made, I think, one. That's because Tusculum was homecoming.
Yeah.
That one particular year. So I actually went down a little early and played in the alumni game down there. So that was fun times. Talked about today in Division I football, the big upset really was the Tennessee Vols knocking off. I mean, I think it's more of just a big upset because no one saw it. No one saw that one at all.
No, Auburn ranked number 21 in the country, I believe it was. So Vols is their first SEC victory since 2016. And, of course, I know they don't play every year, so it's a misleading statistic, but I think TV said first win over Auburn since 1999.
Yeah, it may have been like they played twice this century and had lost both of those games. Florida did survive Vanderbilt today as well, so big scare. And Pitt is leading Notre Dame, another game to kind of watch in Division I. So let's start the second half. It's foot to leather and the Pioneers. Lorenzo Pratt fields this one at the 10, 15, 20, 25, and he'll be taken down at about the 27 by his headgear, and it will be first and 10 for the Pioneers from there.
Had one tackle to break, couldn't quite get away, but still, decent return. Going to start the Pioneers up past the 25-yard line.
So Pratt, who averages 21.7 yards a return on his fourth return of the year. Of course, we lose Jay Boyd for the year with the ACL in the LR game, was averaging 28 yards a return and earned the All-American status in his first season at Tusculum because of his kick-returning prowess.
First down, Wolf, Correction, Pioneers.
So under center is going to be Ogle. It'll be Maxwell Joseph who will get the start in the second half and the first carry for the Pioneers from the 27, 30, and up to the 33-yard line and is tackled there by Kardeem Hines, who feels now awkward to even try to attempt to stop Maxwell Joseph.
I mean, that was a solid run by Maxwell Joseph. Just put his head down, powered through, and got the Pioneers a good working here on second down.
Joseph cuts and moves it right back up the field as he makes and puts his right foot into the ground and gets up to the 35. So it's third down and two for the Pioneers as Maxwell Joseph has run for 8 yards on two carries.
Well, I mean, and the thing that we want to watch is because we've seen him fumble in those situations. So right now I'm still kind of – I want to give him benefit of the doubt that he's not, but I still kind of cringe in these situations. Like just keep ball security and safety and move change forward.
Yeah, just hang on to it. Don't give it up. Last year he had 18 carries for 126 yards in the game against the Newberry Wolves and obviously hasn't been that much of a factor here. That just his third carry of the day. This will be Ogle to pass and throws it behind Bellinger, incomplete off the turf. Bellinger may have kicked it up into the air and running it all the way back will be Anthony Blue into the end zone. He thought he scored as the ball was into the air, but it actually did hit off the turf. You could see the sand.
It hit mouse. Not exactly sure whenever you got the running game as Pioneers do. You've got Joseph. You needed to punch it up 2 yards to get a first down while you tried to throw the ball in that situation.
And it's just not a good throw. You know, it was behind the intended target. And Bellinger, if it's a good throw, it's an easy call. But Maxwell Joseph is a big back capable of getting you those couple of yards. So Cantrell to punt. Newberry does not come after it. It's a line drive punt. It'll be fielded at the 30 and then blown up on the play. Penalty flags are down. And did they – there was no – was there a fair catch asked for, or was there a block in the back in the process? Didn't ask for the fair catch, and I think they're going to get a block in the back.
There's no way that can be against the Pioneers unless you're going to get them for excessive tackling or something, because, I mean, it was just a good, clean play.
He actually took a step after he caught the ball, so no way this can be kick-catch interference. They're definitely taking a long time to talk about this.
Here's the replay if we look behind us.
Yeah, block in the back. So the block in the back, it's pretty evident. It's just a good play by the gunner for the punt. Yeah, it's obvious that he got blocked in the back. And just a phenomenal open field tackle. Tell you what, these special teams guys for the Pioneers, that's Ryan McIntyre. Had a chance to talk with him 2 weeks ago. Was at the Pioneer Football Radio Show at Applebee's. And what a great person. Wonderful person to talk to. was excited to be there and is excited in his role as a running back, recruited as a running back, but now he's one of the quickest gunners on this Pioneer football team. So big on special teams for Ryan McIntyre. It will be Greg Ruff to start at quarterback. Markell Castle will go in motion. A little play action. That's Jones, pardon me, in at quarterback. And this pass to Irby complete up to the 29, maybe the 30. They give it to him, and it will be first and 10. The Newberry Wolves move the chains.
Irby did a good job there going up to get it. Not a tall receiver, listed at 5'9". Had to go up in the air to come down with the catch to get the first down for the Wolves.
It's the third quarterback used of the day. That's Dre Harris in at quarterback. And the freshman is under some duress, and he's just going to throw this one away. Getting some good pressure in that backfield for the Pioneers that time was Nelson Luis. And Nelson, who was a prominent factor last week against Mars Hill defensively. And here's a penalty or something going against. I don't know. There is a flag in the backfield. I just now picked it up. And apparently this will go against Tusculum.
Personal foul. Rushing the passer, low hit on the quarterback. Forceful contact, low to the user, quarterback, and has been passing faster. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, on the
line
first down.
Some of these penalties are just absolutely getting ridiculous. Wow.
I guess it's the rules of the game, and that's unfortunate because that's on Nelson Luis, and that's a roughing the passer and a forcible hit on a quarterback in a throwing motion below the knees. That's a lot to process for an official. Is that just too much for officials today?
You know, safety is good. They've got to watch out for head injuries these days. But just whenever you're making a natural football tackle and it just happens to be in.
Barnes on the carry. Luis is going to help out on the stop, but not till the 50-yard line. Pioneers say they have the ball. They do, but they blew the play dead. And it will be second down and 5 for the Newberry Wolves at midfield.
But, you know, continue what I'm saying. At what point are you going to take tackling out of it?
Yeah. When you get back there to the quarterback, it's almost as if you touch him, he's going to be down pretty soon. Maybe. No. But the problem is quarterbacks are competitors too, and they try to break tackles. Here's a little bubble screen complete right at the line of scrimmage. They lose 2 yards, gain the 2 yards back, and it's all of a sudden the same. Third down and 5, no gain.
No gain, and Newberry now have got some work to do. Pioneer defense needs to really hold here and force yet another punt by the Wolves.
Dre Harris, who is the third quarterback used today, the redshirt freshman out of Greenville, South Carolina, Malden High School, two-time All-Region player, completing 52% of his passes this year, had seen more action, had more passing attempts than that of Nick Jones. But Ruff has had a go of it. Jones has had a go of it. It's Harris's go now. This will be Harris to pass and is hit as he delivers it complete at the 50. And Irby goes out of bounds into Pioneer territory at the 42-yard line. Matthews over there on the stop, and it will be first and 10 Newberry.
Pretty good argument right there that could have been holding against the Wolves because I couldn't tell exactly who it was. One of the Pioneer defenders had a straight shot at the quarterback and he was held back.
There have been two very obvious holds with jerseys coming from the shoulder pads for the defensive line in this game that have been very evident from way up here. So first and 10 for the Newberry Wolves. Barnes in the backfield is going to get the handoff, and he's going to be blown up and driven backwards by Ivan Hogans, who's got another hit behind the line, and they have not been able to contain Ivan Hogans, or at least you and I have called Ivan Hogans' name all game, but he hadn't had more than 3 tackles in the game.
I mean, he just... Every play we've had Ivan Hogan, so I'm not exactly sure where the credit is not being given, but he's been under.
Second down and 11, another hit behind the line. We've got him for at least 3 behind the line today. That would give him his season totals. He had 3 coming into today. So second and 11, 11 minutes to play in the third, 7-0 Tusculum. Harris working from the gun, Barnes on his right shoulder. Barnes to pass, looking, and he's going to be scrambling, and Ivan Hogans is going to get there and bring him down back into Newberry territory at the 47-yard line. It's going to bring up a third down and long.
Great, great pressure there by the Pioneers, just pushing the quarterback back. Newberry's lucky that they didn't have a turnover right there because he tried to get rid of it by throwing it out, and fortunately for them and unfortunately for the Pioneers, the ball rolled out of bounds.
When Hogans made the tackle and was bringing Harris to the ground, he got stepped on by C.J. Bartley in the process. So Hogans right now holding and clutching his right arm. So third down The line to gain, the Pioneer 42, the Wolves scrimmage from their 45-yard line. Or pardon me, the line to gain, the Pioneer 32, the original line of scrimmage, is the 42. This will be Harris going to step up and going to throw it deep and just threw it over the head of everybody. Had Irby open in the middle of the defense, but Malik Goodman was lurking, and it will be fourth down.
Fourth down from Newberry Center. Punt unit on one more time.
So the sack, again, with Newberry driving, getting a little bit of momentum, we're able to come up with that stop for the Pioneers and defensively force a Shea Rogers punt. DeAlfords is back deep. Snap is low. Rogers comes up with it and gets rid of it in a hurry. And Alford will muff it but fall right on top of it. He asked for the fair catch at the 24-yard line, and he was able to fall right down on top of it. And it will be first and 10. And a bunch of guys right now coming up lame. David Johnson is coming up lame, and Ivan Hogan's getting checked out on the sideline, and Lorenzo Pratt being checked out on the sideline as well.
Yeah, I was just sitting here looking at Pratt. He's sitting on the training table, helmet off. In his case, he's not even really being looked at, so probably they've evaluated him and decided that he just needs to sit a while.
We apparently have added media timeouts in football games, so let's go to a timeout. 10:04 to play here in the third quarter. We go to a break with your score, Tusculum 7 and Newberry 0. Pioneer football continues after this on the...
The first date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry. This might be new for you, but Ingles has been there before. From flowers to the freshest ingredients, we have everything you need to put your best foot forward.
I'm so sorry.
Remember, you can't get to happily ever after without once upon a time.
Wow, funny running to
Ingles, all the ingredients for family. So much of life these days is rushing around from one place to another. Sometimes you just want to enjoy the journey on the way to the destination. And part of what makes it a little more enjoyable is an appreciation for the folks who help you get there. At Ingles, we know that the people who send you on your way are the same ones who keep you coming back.
I think you should take it for a spin. Are you serious?
Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
So we welcome you back into Pioneer Field out of the timeout. The Pioneers, second offensive possession here of this second half, leading 7-0. Under center, Tommy Pistone for the Pioneers. Hand off, this will be Maxwell Joseph, a little stutter step in the backfield. He'll cross the 25 and carry it up to the 29-yard line. Going to be a gain of 5, second down and 5 coming up for the Pioneers.
Pioneers continue to rotate the quarterback. We've seen Alex Ogle for the most part. Pistone got the start. Now he's back in here in the third quarter.
Play, second and 5, Pioneers.
7-0, Tusculum as mentioned. They score on a Will Boney 1-yard touchdown run in the second quarter. And that's been it. Two top defenses on display here today from Pioneer Field. Pistone will work out of the gun. Joseph in the backfield with him with four wideouts in the formation. Pistone, a little quick hitter. This will be Joseph, breaks a tackle, 30, 35, and then just lowered the shoulder and laid the boom on the tackler, Jawanza Adams, in the secondary. But there is a flag down back where Pistone let the ball fly, and Newberry says it's going to be on Tusculum.
Didn't really see it because, honestly, I was watching the flight of the ball. I was seeing who was catching it. It is going to go against the Pioneers, watching Coach Odom.
So a hold that will go against the Pioneers. And it is tough to deal with this, the defensive line. Let me tell you, Jamarcus Henderson leads all Division II, ranked second across three divisions for his career in tackle for loss yards at 260. Third overall with 54 career tackles for loss, 26 and a half sacks. That's also third among active Division II leaders. That's a handful when you got a guy like that, the senior out of Union, South Carolina. Add to that Ty Kelly, Drew Sprouse, and Kalijah Brown. So on second down and 15, not much here. And in the middle of the play is going to be Kieran Murphy and Keto Jordan. So third down and 14 coming up for the Pioneers.
And the Pioneers had the first down. Getting first downs is tough enough in this game. Having to get the same first down twice, not a situation you want to put yourself in with penalties.
So the Pioneers, Pistone, who was 0-for-2 on that first drive, gets the completion to Joseph, who breaks a tackle and just runs hard. He runs behind his pads. He'll be out of the game right now. Pistone with a man in the backfield. Shippey, you're going to lob it down the field for Bellinger, and Bellinger defended by Anthony Blue, and that's going to be incomplete. So Pistone was trying to give Bellinger a chance to go get it, just overthrew his intended target, and he's 0-for-3 on the day, and it's fourth down for the Pioneers.
Bellinger got tripped up there, so don't know whether he could have gotten to the ball or not. Pioneer coaching staff obviously wanted pass interference. They didn't get it, and so here we see Cantrell again.
So Cantrell punting from now inside his 10, had two punts from his goal line and in the end zone in that first half. And now Irby will go drift back to stand at his 45. Cantrell, little pressure, gets away a good one. Irby drifts back inside the 40, asks for the fair catch, receives it inside the 35-yard line at the 34, and that's where the Newberry Wolves will take over. First and 10 as we play here in the third quarter with 8:13 to play in the third.
I mean, this defensive battle continues. Newberry did a good job holding the Pioneers, forcing the punt. We'll see if Tusculum can respond in kind.
So, Newberry, which quarterback will they throw out there right now? Coming out is going to be the redshirt freshman. That'll be Dre Harris, who will come out for the Newberry Wolves. So, first and 10 from their 34, down 7-0. They'll run a reverse. Pioneers are ready for it, but can they contain Castle? They do. Do a decent job on the play. Castle gains maybe 3 as he crosses the 35 to about the 36-yard line. They'll say second down and 7 on the pickup of 3.
Might have been a little bit less pickup than that if it hadn't been for a hold over on that far sideline.
It's just really easy to see from up here. I'm not exactly sure what's going on down there. Actually, just a gain of 2. They said he stepped out before the 37. So at the 36. Harris with Barnes on his right shoulder, lining up in the gun for the Newberry Wolves. Little play action pass. This is going to be complete to Castle, 45. Got away from Bartlett, then stays on his feet, gets into Pioneer territory, and takes it down to the 41. First and 10, and our first Markell Castle sighting of the day.
Well, I mean, Castle, he's the one that you really have to keep a lookout coming into today's game. He had 27 catches, averaging 15.4 and 4 touchdowns.
Not really sure how he got away from Bartlett. Looked like a little rub route, maybe just a little professional offensive pass interference. Either way, is a good delivery by Harris. Good catch and run. 7-0 Tusculum. Newberry lead has it first and 10 at the Pioneer 41. They'll send Castle in motion across the formation, hand it off to Barnes, and he'll take it inside the 40 to the 39-yard line as Randy Hooks in that defensive line there for the Pioneers. Second down and 8, as that's C.J. Bartley on that stop.
Yeah, good job by Bartley up front, just forcing through, not allowing Newberry to punch through the middle.
Second down and 8 coming up for the Wolves. Keenan Lewis and Castle to the near sideline. Clark to the far side. Barnes on the right shoulder of Harris, who works out of the gun, the redshirt freshman. This will be Barnes, and he'll fight his way down to about the 35-yard line, and it will be third down and 4 coming up for the Wolves, as coming up off the bottom of that pile, Bartley and Devin Woodson.
Now, here's a situation where you feel pretty certain Pioneer defense is going to have to hold for 2 plays because Newberry's in the area. They're not really going to want to punt, especially right now, getting down less than half of the third quarter to go.
Harris, Barnes to his right, bring Clark in motion, fake it to him, and a penalty, and that came from the umpire. That may be another penalty on third down against Newberry, which that has killed the Wolves on the day. Yeah, false start going on the Newberry Wolves. That came from the umpire, as mentioned. So now it's third down and 9, back at the 40.
And that puts a new dimension on what the Pioneer defense has to do. You obviously have got to get this third down stop, but now Newberry could be pushed back even outside of going for it twice.
You bring in the pass rusher, Nelson Luis. You got Bartley on the right, Luis on the left. And in the middle of that defensively, you got Ahmad Gandy and Colton Strickland. So it will be Harris, who works from the gun. Barnes, new running back, is going to be Cook. Harris going to just let it fly. This pass is going to be knocked away by David Johnson, and that one was just thrown up for grabs. As a matter of fact, Malik Goodman was on the right hash. He ran all the way across the field and also had a chance at that Paul.
And here we see a punter coming on once again for Newberry. It's Shea Rogers. He's certainly getting work out this afternoon.
Broken up by number 24, David Johnson.
So Johnson, who breaks up the pass.
It's fourth down, Newberry.
Shea Rogers will come on to punt it away for Newberry. Good snap. Rogers angling. It actually goes right up the middle. Pioneers run away from it, and they tried to fool Newberry, and that's bad because it rolls inside the five, and it is touched up right at the goal line. And so the Pioneers scrimmage, why not run over there and field that?
I don't
understand sometimes.
I don't know. Tusculum certainly has its work cut out for them on this drive. If they go, it's going to be 99 yards before they can reach the end zone.
So the Pioneers have first and 10 from their one, and Alex Ogle will come back out at quarterback. We've seen five quarterbacks today. Newberry played a game last year where they used seven quarterbacks themselves. They already used two quarterbacks, but both of them got injured in the game, and so the running backs just played the Wildcat the rest of the game. First down and 10 at the one. Ogle to pass. It's incomplete, intended for Aaron Fudge. And did we get a false start?
Timeout.
No, a timeout
Newberry.
On Newberry.
This is the first start.
So we'll take the timeout. Back to Pioneer Field, returning in 30 seconds. 5:27 to play in the third. Tusculum leads the Wolves 7-0.
The first date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry. This might be new for you, but Ingles has been there before. From flowers to the freshest ingredients, we have everything you need to put your best foot forward.
I'm sorry.
Remember, you can't get to happily ever after without once upon a time.
Wow, funny running to
Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
Ten for the Pioneers out of the Newberry Wolves timeout. Don't forget, next week, the Pioneers on the road. We travel to Catawba. One home game left. That's the great rivalry, the Battle of U.S. 11E, Tusculum and Carson Newman in 2 weeks. First and 10 from the goal line for the Pioneers. This is going to be Shippey. He's found daylight. 5, 10. He's into the secondary. 30. Shippey at the 40. Shippey to the 50. To the 40 and is forced out of bounds after a pickup of 59 yards for Jordan Shippey.
Once he hit the corner, it was absolutely a track meet going down through there. Shippey had the speed, had three Newberry defenders trailing after him, and was able to force him out of bounds, but still great job by Shippey.
They're going to mark him out at the 41-yard line, where that will be a gain of 58. And for Jordan Shippey, his career long. Maxwell Joseph, the tailback. And all of a sudden, the Pioneers have flipped the field. Under 5 to play. Maxwell Joseph gets a carry, runs it right up the middle, pounding his way inside the 40. And the ball has been stripped free of Joseph, but that was after he was downed at the 36-yard line. And a little extra afterward. Right now, tempers flaring in this extremely tight defensive struggle, and the Pioneers have the biggest play of the game.
Well, unfortunately, it might have been costly.
That popcorn gets you every
popcorn
time.
Popcorn gets me here. Shippey, after that big run, he came right off the field on his own and just headed straight over here to the bench and took a seat. It looked like he's favoring his knee.
Yeah, he's been battling a bit of a knee injury, but Shippey with the biggest run of the game. And against the best run defense in the league, that is definitely what the Pioneers needed from their own one. Here's a receiver slant that's going to be complete at the 30, 25, and down to the 20-yard line on that far side at Jake Moss for the Pioneers. Actually, it's Aaron Fudge for the Pioneers who makes a big catch, and we haven't seen an Aaron Fudge sighting since the shorter contest when he caught that touchdown.
Speaking of popcorn, as always, we've got to thank Roxy for taking care of us.
Absolutely. Got to thank Roxy.
She has for years.
Thinking of Mary Helen Paxton as well, who's missing another home game. So I know that you're back watching or listening. Either way, we appreciate you doing that. Miss you and hope that you're going to be better and back for that Carson Newman showdown in 2 weeks. Handoff fullback, and is this Brooklander, who's not going to get much. And that will bring up second down and about 10 once again. Just trying to get Gary Brooklander the ball in any way we can. Good offensive threat. But Mary Helen has been a bit under the weather over the really the last month or so. I know that the women's basketball coaching staff and some of the players went out to a visit to see that she was doing well. And you know that brightens your day.
Yeah, it really does. Anytime that you know somebody's thinking about you.
Second down, about 9.5. Ogle and the Pioneers have it at the Newberry 21-yard line. Joseph is the tailback. Brooklander is the fullback. Ogle, five-step drop, and he's going to throw it to the end zone, and that one's going to be incomplete. Bellinger is complaining that he is being held once again, and that time I believe it. Bellinger is a tough hand. He's a tough handle on this day, but now it's third down and 10 for the Pioneers, who've only converted 2 of 9 on the day.
Also taking note of people, one of my former students, Grace Rowe, freshman here at Tusculum. She was in the homecoming court, so I'm proud of her.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I didn't see who the king and queen were today.
I didn't catch the names. I did see a young lady walking around in here with a crown, but I'm not sure who she is.
Out of the gun will be Ogle. Joseph will line up on his right shoulder. Pioneers without Pratt and now without Shippey. This will be a toss to Aaron Fudge and a jet sweep. He has it at the 15. Fudge at the 10. Spins to the 5. First and goal for the Pioneers. They convert on third down and 10 against the stingiest third down defense in the league.
Huge play for the Pioneers. Good play calling there. Good execution by the guys on the field. Put Tusculum down, knocking on the door once again.
Pioneers without Torrey Ponder. He was injured in the first half. He's got a knee sleeve on and crutches. Pioneers without Shippey. At this moment, Gamillion, who had put it on the floor, hasn't had the go. Pratt has been out. Here is Maxwell Joseph lining up behind Ogle, who's going to change the play, or at least the direction of the blocking scheme. They're going to hand it off to Joseph. He'll lower the helmet, and he'll get inside the 5 and down to about the 2, maybe the 2-yard line, where it'll be second and goal for the Pioneers.
Actually, a pretty good play for Joseph there. He took the ball, started to the right side, took one stutter step back to the left and was able to move up some yardage.
That zone blocking and that cutback running lane for Maxwell Joseph. Will Boney will come in. You've always got to be worried about him with the quick handoff. They're a little far away from the line of scrimmage. They're at the 2. But Boney will line up as an H-back with Brooklander to the right. Those guys will adjust, and Boney will come as the fullback. Brooklander, the H-back, now to the left. Joseph is the tailback, and it will be play-action fake. The pass to Brooklander is caught at the goal line. Did he hang on to it? He did. Touchdown, Pioneers! Touchdown, Gary Brooklander. Check that. Touchdown for Connor Johnston. Johnston with the touchdown, and the Pioneers add to their lead.
Good sell job there by the Pioneers. Showed run. Newberry bit on that, and that was just a good job by everybody to get into the end zone.
So Connor Johnston with the big 2-point conversion last year to win it has the touchdown reception in this one as he and Brooklander were lined up to the right and he was short. Brooklander went deep in the end zone and Ogle threw the short route. Defada with the point. Donnelly to snap. Fowler to hold. Kick is up. And the kick is good. We go to a break, and the Pioneers have added to their lead thanks to Jordan Shippey getting the Pioneers on a 99-yard drive. A minute 31 left in the third. Tusculum 14, Newberry 0. Pioneer football continues after this.
So much of life these days is rushing around from one place to another. Sometimes you just want to enjoy the journey on the way to the destination. And part of what makes it a little more enjoyable is an appreciation for the folks who help you get there. At Ingles, we know that the people who send you on your way are the same ones who keep you coming back.
I think you should take it for a spin. Are you serious?
Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
So the Pioneers, 99-yard drive. You talked about it, Joe. If the Pioneers are going to score here, it's going to take a while. 8 plays, 99 yards, 3:57 off the clock. Pretty good drive.
Minute and a half left here in the third quarter. Pioneers seemingly take control. 2-touchdown lead is not safe, but I like the position that they're in.
The way the game has gone defensively. Glick is going to put this one through the end zone, and it'll be a touchback as Chance Walker will watch it go through. So the Pioneers with the Connor Johnston reception for a touchdown. You know, tight ends have not been utilized as much this year. Johnston had just one catch prior coming into today, now with the second and his first touchdown this year. The other was the game against Shorter, and that probably should have been a score because they had underthrown him.
You know, if a team uses tight ends properly, just look at some of your top NFL players. It's your tight ends. These guys are good around the goal line.
Apparently, Dre Harris is going to get the go the rest of this, at least third quarter. Harris back to pass, has a man wide open. Markel Castle, 35-40, tripped up at the 47-yard line. I mean, he was wide open. That's one of the best receivers in our league, all unaccounted for, and D. Alford has to make a quick stop.
Yeah, it's unfortunate for the Pioneers. I don't know if it was a breakdown in coverage, if they just forgot about Castle because he's not been so involved in the game, but he certainly burned Tusculum on that play.
So first and 10 on a pickup of 27 yards for Markel Castle and movement on Newberry, and they'll start behind the chains. Holy cow. They've been penalized a few times today.
That's going to be the eighth penalty for the Wolves. Eight penalties for 65 yards now.
And they average about 69.5 yards a game penalty yardage. Tusculum about 64. And a lot of that from last week, over 100 yards in penalty yards and 13 penalties against Tusculum. Harris working out of the gun. Irby, along with Clark to the far side. To the near side is Kitchens, along with Castle. Harris runs the option and will pitch it out to Barnes. Barnes gets the corner and gets the 5 yards lost on the false start and maybe a yard after that. So it'll bring up second down, close to 10 either way, with 41 seconds to play in the third. He stepped out after a gain of 4.
You mentioned those penalties. Newberry now has 8 penalties for 65 yards. Tusculum, 7 penalties for 70 yards.
Second down, Newberry.
So Tusculum leading 14-0 with 20 seconds to play here in the third. Harris to pass on second and 11. Across the middle, he's got a man, is going to be incomplete. Unable to hang on to it was Clark, and I think David Johnson ripped that one out. He did. Good job defensively by the corner, David Johnson and Malik Goodman.
Ryan, first conference game of the day has gone final. Lenore Ryan gets a win over Limestone at home. Lenore Ryan winning 63-17.
They can score some points, can't they?
Yes, they can. Didn't score on us in the first half.
But they eventually got going. So third down, 11. 14 seconds to play in the third. Dre Harris works from the gun. He's got Barnes on his right shoulder. We'll adjust him to the left shoulder. Trips to the near side. And they're going to throw the screen. He just overthrown him. Incomplete as they overthrow the target to the left. And it will be fourth down for the Wolves with 11 seconds to play here in the quarter.
Fourth and 11. So right now, you kind of wonder at what point Newberry decides to start going for it. Not going to be while there's still time left on the clock here in the third.
Last time the Pioneers defeated Newberry here was 2014. You remember that game? It was like a mud bowl in a way?
Yeah, not like the classic mud bowl over at Mars Hill, but it was a very rainy day and muddy.
Rogers to punt it. Gets the spiral to turn over. Alford fair catch at the 12. And there'll be 4 seconds left in the quarter. And more on, in that game, if you'll recall, Todd Knight, because it was so bad, just decided we're just going to go power eye. They ran a high school formation. Forgive me for that comparison. But it was just two fullbacks and a running back the entire second half. They led 14-3, and Tusculum was able to come back and win the game 16-14.
Just a soupy, sloppy day and bouncing around here. And it did, you know. Footing was a premium for everybody.
Yeah, it was. You're exactly right. First down and 10 here for the Pioneers. They scrimmage from the 12. Ogle to pass, and this one complete to Aaron Fudge. Boy, what a game, as he'll have the first down across the 20 and up to about the 24-yard line. Fudge showing his strength, staying on his feet, and that will end the third quarter of play. At the end of three, it's Tusculum 14. It's Newberry 0. Pioneer football continues after this for Homecoming 2018 on the Pioneers Sports Network.
It's fine.
fine. It'll be okay, okay? Nobody cares about the flowers. Who needs flowers at a wedding?
At Ingles, we know that the best of plans don't always go according to plan.
My best friend's getting married today and the florist never showed.
That's why we're always there when you need us.
What are their colors?
Herbal and cream.
With smiling faces and helping hands.
No one cares. No one cares. You will look great. Flowers are not important. And where is Holly? Have anyone seen Holly?
And although life will be predictably unpredictable,
let's get you to that wedding.
A curveball is that much more satisfying.
I got the flowers!
When you knock it out of the park.
Oh my gosh, this is awesome!
So when the plan goes out the window and improvisation becomes the order of the day, just remember, that's where the best of memories are made.
All right, they're ready for us.
True story. Ingles. All
for Catawba will await this defense that has been good, and the sprinklers have come on, and Jerry Odom has just taken it right in the gut. He is soaking wet, and he is red hot. He is angry. Look at him. He's angry. He's so mad right now. Holy cow. Somebody get a shot of that down there on the sideline. Look at him. He's angry. Handoff. This is going to be the Pioneers, and that's going to be Shippey, who has put himself back into the game. He'll carry it up to the 30. It's a six-yard game, but before we went to break to end the third quarter, Aaron Fudge factoring prominently for the injured Torrey Ponder in this one, Joe. And he's got an end around for a first down to the 5 on third down and 10. And on Pioneers backed up to their 12, he gets it out to the 24-yard line.
He's done a lot of work here. Doesn't have a lot of catches, really. Three now, I think. That last one was his third. But they've been important.
Yeah. One was a touchdown against Shorter. And just showing his height and his physicality to go up on basically just a ball thrown into the end zone for him. Pass across the middle, Jake Moss, 40, 45, 50 to the Newberry 45-yard line. First and 10 for the Pioneers. What a throw by Alex Ogle that time.
Good throw by Ogle. Good throw by Moss just to continue to move forward. And right now, just think what a touchdown can do.
14-0, Tusculum leading here in this fourth quarter as we have just started the fourth. And this Pioneer football team right now is on the move. Alex Ogle is feeling it here in this one. Turn around and hand this one off to Shippey. Makes the cut. Daylight 40. He's down to the 35. Two penalty flags thrown. And that right in the area where he broke to Daylight, which leads me to believe this will go against Tusculum.
Yeah, generally when that situation comes, not just one flag, two flag, you know what it's going to be.
You talked about some of the scores in the LR game going final as Carson Newman is handling Morris Hill. I do believe that's about the score Tusculum could have had last week as well.
Yeah, right now Carson Newman putting work in. Third quarter leads 42-14 over the Lions, Morris Hill.
Now, keep in mind the Pioneers, who get the 99-yard drive, now have 236 yards entering the fourth quarter of offense. And that's with a 99-yard drive. This has been offense has come at a premium here in this game.
It really has. And the Pioneers have been fortunate enough to capitalize whenever they really got the ball down close to the goal line.
First down, 17 for the Pioneers from their own 47-yard line. Draw, this is going to be Maurice Gamillion, who takes it back into Newberry territory down to the 46-yard line. So the area they lose on the hold that they get back on the 7 yards. It's second down and 10 now for the Pioneers as Joe Blue in on another stop.
I was thinking about the sprinklers coming on. I think that's something new that we've not seen here. That I was at a baseball game over at it was Greenville Astros at the time, and it went late into the night, and the sprinklers were on a timer, and they popped on for just a second before somebody realized, oh.
But I don't even understand why they would even – I mean, they came on for less than a second.
Somebody must have leaned up against the switch.
Second down 10 at the Newberry 46-yard line, and I don't think Brian Ferguson liked the setup and looked over and told Alex, hey, hold up, let's take a timeout. So the Pioneers will burn one, and we'll take it as well. We'll return 30 seconds to Pioneer Field. With your score, 12:52 to play, Pioneers lead the Wolves by 14.
The first date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry. This might be new for you, but Ingles has been there before.
You look
From flowers to the freshest ingredients, we have everything you need to put your best foot forward.
I'm so sorry.
Remember, you can't get to happily ever after without once upon a time.
Wow, funny running into you.
Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
Second down and 10. Timeout by the Pioneers. And Joe talked about it here at the start of this drive. A score here goes a long way.
Yeah, right now, I like being up two touchdowns in the fourth quarter. I like it much better than being down two touchdowns, but it's still not a safe lead.
Right. Quick strike offense for Newberry. Anytime Markell Castle is on the field. Second down and 10 for the Pioneers. Play action fake. This will be Ogle. He's under some pressure. He gets away from it, scrambling. Just get rid of it. And he's going to be sacked back at the 48. Throw it away, Alex.
Yeah, I'm not sure what he was trying to. Obviously, he was trying to scramble to make something happen, but he should have just thrown the ball away and preserved yardage, because now the Pioneers are looking at third and about, what, 16?
Yeah, about the way they lost that penalty yardage. So third down, 16 for the Pioneers with 12 and a half to play in the game. And the Pioneers, who converted three third downs. Ogle, 12 of 21, 145 yards on the day, which has been good. Aaron Fudge, three catches today, 43 yards. Jordan Sippy, nine carries on this day, including a 58-yarder. Screen to Pratt, and he's got daylight, 50, 45, and he'll be taken out of bounds. I say he had daylight. Joe Blue got there in a hurry along with Jawanda Adams and bring him down about 5 yards shy of the first down at the Newberry 41.
Yeah, now here's a situation where the Pioneers are kind of in. They believe they're going to be going for it. Nope.
I would send him out. Yeah, there you go. Send him out. At least force them to go the long way. It's the smart play. Pioneer defense has done a great job throwing a shutout here today against this Newberry Wolves team. And so fourth down, and Cantrell, who's had a busy day, comes back out. Irby stands at the 10. Cantrell nose down, high and short. Irby is going to drift up and field this one at the 18. I don't like that nose down because you just don't get any distance on. Just go ahead and punt it. See what happens. Angle it. But either way, what can you? He's a Cantrell.
Yeah.
Let him do whatever he wants to do.
Yeah, I mean, it's still, he gets credit for pinning Newberry inside the 20, but it would have been nicer if he could have gotten a little bit farther back up than that.
So Newberry, who was held to 10 points against Florida Tech this year, scored 23 in their win against Carson Newman, 20 in their shutout win against Pembroke, and then put up just 21 points last week in their loss to Lenoir Ryan. Those are their last four games. Have it first down and 10, and here to start the fourth quarter, it's going to be Dre Harris, who's going to stay in there at quarterback for Newberry. Learn this little run-pass option, and the pass is going to be complete to Manny McCord, who was running in motion. They do a good job with this run-pass option stuff, but that time McCord tripped and fell on his own, but gained four on the play.
It is now second down and six here for the Newberry Wolves.
So Kitchens comes to the near side. McCord in the slot. Newberry trying to go with some tempo. Harris to pass, under some pressure, pass across the middle's complete to Castle at the 25, and was dancing around there. And if he had just kept running, he makes the first down easy, as it is third down and a yard. And I think there, C.J. Bartley was a bit gun-shy running after Harris, because I don't – he just kind of stood there, and I think it allowed Harris to be – well, to hit his target.
Yeah, well, and I got to watch Castle, because every one of these passes that he's caught, he's been wide open right back here, right behind the line of scrimmage.
McCord goes in motion across the formation. Harris on third and a yard, and another false start on Newberry. And instead of third and a yard, now it's third down and six for the Wolves, and pre-snap penalties are killing the Wolves.
They really are. Obviously, it's benefiting the Pioneers. Pioneers showing a little bit more discipline on that. If you take a look, most of the Pioneers' penalties have been holding types that have hurt them, but it's almost like Newberry's continue to add up and hurt the Wolves even worse.
So it becomes the third down and six. Newberry's not been great on third down today. Neither is Tusculum, for that matter. Harris rolls the pocket, has time to throw, complete to McCord, and he's going to be stopped shy of the first down. Big play by Quadri Allen, I believe, on that far sideline, and Allen steps up and punishes McCord. It's third down and a yard.
And Newberry going to
send...
Fourth and a yard. Newberry going to send the punt unit on once again. I think if they were a little bit closer to midfield, the Wolves would probably be going for it. Pioneers have to guard against some sort of hard count here to try to draw them offside. So discipline up front for Tusculum is imperative.
And coming off the sideline, Darius Clark. I'm not sure he's a typical gunner. So see if anything might be up the sleeve of Todd Knight. Pioneers have everybody there. Now they back him off in coverage. And the punt away. Alford asking for the fair catch. He falls as he makes the catch at the 31-yard line. So fortunate for the Pioneers to hang on to it. Tusculum will have the ball, a 14-point lead, and 9 minutes and 26 seconds on the clock in the game.
Right now, time is on Tusculum's side. Sustained drive is the key here. Putting points on the board at the end, that's the capper. But right now, I'll try to eat as much of this clock off with just a long drive.
We have reached the timeout here in the fourth quarter. We'll take the break and return to Pioneer Field. 9:26 to play in the game. Tusculum 14, Newberry 0. Pioneer football continues after this.
The first date. Only one chance to make that first impression. Don't worry. This might be new for you, but Ingles has been there before. From flowers to the freshest ingredients, we have everything you need to put your best foot forward.
I'm so sorry.
Remember, you can't get to happily ever after without once upon a time. Ingles, all the ingredients for family.
On the carry, 31, Jordan Shippey. You stop on it around 9, Demarcus Henderson. Second down, Pioneer.
So we start here a little early out of that break, and Jordan Shippey, I don't think he got the handoff cleanly from Alex Ogle and stopped in his tracks either way by Tyran Dixon. And it's second down 15 on a loss of 5 back to the 26. Ogle comes under center, 4 wideouts in the formation. They run their slant, and Bellinger wasn't there because jumping the slant, the defender for the Newberry Wolves, and that actually could have been very dangerous. And a nice job defensively by David Vereen, who's been active. And so it's third down and 15. And so instead of doing what we wanted to do, take a bunch of time off the clock, now we've got it stopped.
Yeah, not first play, they kept the clock running, but unfortunately they went backwards 5 yards. Second play, no yards, plus you stopped the clock.
So third down, 15. Bellinger to the near side with Deshaun Davis. Shippey in the backfield with Ogle, who works from the gun on his right shoulder. Ogle with the snap, lobbing it deep to Davis, complete 40, 45, and he is up to the 47-yard line. They're actually going to say he fumbled the football, but the Pioneers recover it. And really, if it's a better thrown ball by Ogle, and now they're going to say it's incomplete. He took 3 steps.
Yeah, I mean, that was a catch. He came down with the football, took steps, and you've got at least 2 have thrown the black puck on the field to show that it was a turnover after the catch, and some guy come running in from the back to overrule it.
And now the back judge says it wasn't a catch. He took 3 steps. He caught it at the 40, and the ball was at the 47. He took 3 steps to go 7 yards.
And his back was to the back judge. The back judge has no idea if he had the ball or not.
You can't rule that income. You can't rule that. That's a good job getting together and talking about it. I can live with that. But if it's a better thrown ball,
1, 2, 3,
it's a score.
Yeah,
he took 3 easy. He tucked it away and then lost it, and then Jordan Shippey recovered it. So the Pioneers 1st and 10 at their own 48-yard line. Ogle hands off. This will be Shippey trying to work behind his offensive line, and he'll make it to about the midfield. and maybe the 49 of Newberry. Either way, a gain of about 3, second down and 7.
Shippey darting around behind one of his offensive linemen, trying to find a hole, doing everything he can. He just can't find daylight to get through.
On the stop, number 20, Darryl Foster.
If you just throw the ball. You know, Bo Cordell just got inducted into the Sports Hall of Fame. He was probably looking at that play right there going, man, that's 6 for me.
Yep.
No question.
Very much.
He had some of the best wide receivers in a span here at Tusculum when you talk about the guys he had to throw to. Second down and 8, just beyond midfield at the Newberry 49. Ogle, quick 5-step drop, is just going to loft it up and allow Bellinger to go get it. And Ogle falling backwards. Shippey says, my bad, I didn't catch the blitz. And Anthony Blue is down, battling with Bellinger. But I still don't know why you throw the ball the way you do right there for Ogle.
Yeah, I mean, that was an absolute duck just thrown up into the air. I don't know if Blue came down funny because both players leaped into the air, tried to bat the ball, and he probably just came down awkwardly on his knee.
Yeah, I think that's kind of what it is. He's going to be he's going to run off the field. This is his first year. He's the cousin of Joe Blue, the all-conference middle linebacker for the Newberry Wolves, and what a tremendous career that Joe has had. First-team all-selection, first-team all-region, ECAC, preseason first-team all-conference as well. Led the team 5th in the conference last year with 83 tackles. He has averaging 11 tackles a game, which leads the South Atlantic Conference, and he was doing that. He was at least halfway there in the first half with 6 tackles. Haven't called his name a whole lot here in the second half, though. Third down and 8. Well, make it more like third down and 7 for the Pioneers. They need it to the 42, and they have it at the 49 of Newberry. Ogle lofting it, and was looking for Aaron Fudge and threw it into coverage, and Vereen had the best opportunity to catch that one. And so the punt team back out with 7.5 to play.
Ate a little bit of time off the clock, not as much as they'd like, really, right about 2 minutes. Another first down would have been wonderful for the Pioneers.
So Cantrell will be out to punt it away. Irby will go back and stand inside the 20, see where he drifts to. He's going to stand around the 15. Cantrell stands at his 36-yard line. Ball will be snapped from the Newberry 49. Good snap by Donnelly. Cantrell just goes ahead and kicks it away. It's going to hit inside the 10, 5, and roll into the end zone. Nice job by Irby selling it. Fooled the Pioneer kick coverage that time. And it'll be Newberry ball, first and 10 at the 20.
Yeah, Coach Odom not happy right now with these guys not looking for the football because it could have easily been downed inside the 5 for the Pioneers, but the guys just stopped whenever they did. The ball hit and rolled in.
Well, the Pioneer defense pitching a shutout right now. Coach Odom not happy at all with his effort last week against the Mars Hill Lions. Their defense has been a little different today. And they have confused the 3 quarterbacks used for Newberry, but it has been all Dre Harris here in the second half.
Yeah, I mean, really has been. Newberry has done a better job moving the football. Penalties have been costly, but give that Tusculum defense a chance to take holding them when they need to.
First and 10 at the 20, 4 wideouts in the formation. This will be Dre Harris. He'll roll the pocket, and he'll throw it under pressure by the Pioneers. I think that was Josh Forrest. And Josh Forrest, along with Nelson Lewis, get the pressure, and it's second down and 10.
Almost a sack there for the Pioneers quarterback, getting rid of it just at the last moment.
Clock has stopped with 7:14 left in the game. Tusculum leading it 14-0, a second quarter and a third quarter score. And the third quarter score was a 99-yard drive, and, of course, 58 of that on one play, the running play from Shippey from the 1. Harris back to pass under pressure, and he's going to take it to the 25-yard line. There is Josh Forrest and Clemens, who combine on the stop. Gain of 5, third down and 5 for Newberry.
Right here, big play for the Pioneers. Hold him again, force Newberry to punt the ball away, get it back, and then try to eat up the clock on the ground.
So third down for the Wolves. Cook is in the backfield with Dre Harris. 3 wideouts to the far side. 1 to the near side for Newberry is Irby. Harris looks his way with the snap. Steps up in the pocket. C.J. Bartley will pressure and passes complete to Irby. He lost it out of bounds. It was fumbled. They're going to say incomplete. Took a couple of steps, and the official quickly ruled it. Never had it, and the ball was broken up. by D. Alford once again.
That's a situation where, just like the previous play that benefited the Pioneers, I kind of think he had the ball for
a brief second there.
Still replays a play behind here. But either way, Newberry coming on to punt again. Under 6.5 minutes left in the game here today.
So Shea Rogers out to punt it once again for Newberry. And an offense that has been sputtering. A low snap. And Shea Rogers gets it away. It's going to take a nice Newberry roll. And this will be his best effort of the day. Because it was a low snap, he punted it quickly. A Pioneer football team that will come out and have the ball inside the 20 at the 18. And a nice job by Shea Rogers to get that one.
Got a little information in here, but we're not going to read that just yet.
Yeah, we're not going to do that just yet. But that's good to have. So a Pioneer football team that will have it first and 10 at the 18, leading 14-0.
Right now, 6 minutes, 12 seconds on the clock whenever it resumes. Pioneer's a lot of room to go here.
Maxwell Joseph is the lone tailback, and he'll get the handoff, and he'll run it hard across the 20 and up to about the 22, maybe the 23-yard line, and there on the stop is going to be Terrell Owens. Shea Rogers' punt of 57 yards put the Pioneers back inside their 20, but Maxwell Joseph picks up 5 yards on first down.
Yeah, Maxwell Joseph can just do that on every play. The Pioneers are going to be in really good shape. Just keep chugging it right up the middle and watching the seconds tick off the clock.
Pioneers have it under 6 minutes. That's 5:40 on the clock now. Two wideouts line up to the far side. Ogle under center with Joseph, the lone tailback. Joseph is going to be run blitzed and does well just to get the handoff. Keto Jordan was one of the first back there. And a penalty flag is flown. Is on the ground, and I believe it will be because they allowed the play an offside by Newberry.
Yeah, I think Newberry was already coming across whenever the ball was snapped.
At the snap, offside, defense number 55.
Keto Jordan, who made the play, is whistled for the offside play as well.
See if it's going to be a
first down
for the Pioneers,
right at 5 yards. Pioneers have 7 different receivers with a catch today, 3 with 3 receptions. Aaron Fudge, A.J. Bellinger, each with 3. 2 apiece for Connor Johnston, Lorenzo Pratt, and Deshaun Davis on the day. Deshaun Davis with the 48 yards and really the 26-yarder that he had early. And then the 17-yarder moments ago should have gone for a score of 60 yards. With 5 minutes to play, Pioneers burn a timeout just before the play clock hit 0.
And I think that was just because they realized that it was getting ready to be a penalty. It's not that they weren't trying to get set. It's they were trying to save 5 yards.
So let's go to a break as well. Back in 30 seconds to Pioneer Field. 4:59 to play in the game. Pioneers continue to lead the Wolves by 14.
Family.
Food's here!
What's it mean to you? To us, it means the people you care about, look out for, and yeah, love. Even if you'd never let them hear you say it.
Hey, you're eating hummus?
What's wrong with hummus?
Here at Ingles, we have everything you need to gather around the table and give each other a hard time. Because that's what families do. Ingles. All the ingredients for family.
Field where the Tusculum Pioneers lead 14-0 against the Newberry Wolves. They have the ball, a first down, new set of downs, and 4:59 on the clock.
And the clock right now is Tusculum's friend as long as they can keep it moving.
So, Ogle, who has gone much of the way today, Pistone did get a start, did also get another series, but outside of that, it's been Alex Ogle's game, 14 of 26 with a score and 178 yards passing. Pioneers maximum protection, run blitz, and Ogle's is going to be taken down by his face mask, and as a matter of fact, his entire helmet has been ripped off of his head by Anthony Moffitt, and that'll be a free 15 yards. And they may have jumped off sides again.
Well, I think that second penalty is probably going to be something that was going on after the play. Not sure who it's going to be on.
Ogle doesn't have to come out of the game if his helmet was ripped from his person. But he's over on the sidelines. And I don't know why there's that much of a discussion over what's going on. It's a personal foul penalty, and you mark that off from the line of scrimmage. You don't credit the defense for getting the tackle all the way back at the 15.
But then we're going to have to sort out what this second penalty was.
There are multiple fouls on the play.
Let's check
it. First play happened during the ball and was live. Personal foul face mask, number 27 of the defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Number 18 is allowed to remain in the game because the helmet came off due to a foul. After the play, it's personal-like conduct.
So 30 yards been tacked on from the original line of scrimmage.
So Coach Todd Knight from the Newberry Wolves not going to be happy with that. You're still in a game. You still have an opportunity to win, but you gave up 30 yards on one play with two penalties. That's you know, very bad discipline for your team, and now you've given Tusculum new life big time.
So Pioneers have it first and 10 at the Newberry 42-yard line, leading 14-0, 4:45 and counting. Ogle turns around, hands it off to Joseph. He fumbled it, and the Newberry Wolves have it. Unbelievable. He never got it cleanly. It was just not, I don't know if it was the exchange, but Maxwell Joseph fumbles it. Newberry has it. And with 4:40 to play, here they've got some life. They haven't had field position the entire game. And all of a sudden, they're coming out from the Pioneer 46-yard line.
Pioneers had a chance. Even a field goal could have sealed this thing. But now, instead of capitalizing on that 30 yards, you essentially just punted it away. And Newberry's got good starting field position.
So first and 10, Newberry on the miscue by the Pioneers. Newberry with Harris out at quarterback. Four wideouts to either side for the Wolves. Barnes is the tailback. Harris going to take off running, and Harris is going to be ripped down at the Pioneer 45-yard line, and that'll be a gain of 9. It's second down and a yard, 4.5 to play in the game. Clock runs.
Clock does run. Both teams have timeouts left. Newberry with 2, Tusculum with 1, should it need it.
It's a Pioneer team. With Harris passing, had a man wide open, hit him in the wrong place. It hit McCord right in the hands, and he couldn't hang on to it. Incomplete.
Well, that's a break for the Pioneers, because that was going to be a good first down pickup for Newberry and keep that momentum going for them, and it was a mistake by the Wolves.
There's been a lot of open guys right in the middle of the field, right in the middle of that defense.
Most of Newberry's passing yards have come from somebody just getting right in behind what normally about where your linebackers would be.
Third down and a yard for the Wolves. Clock is at 4:12 in the game, 14-0 Tusculum. Harris to pass. Now he's going to be in trouble, and he's going to let it go, and that's going to be incomplete. That has got to be an intentional grounding.
There's absolutely nobody on that part of the football field.
It's just fortunate for Newberry.
Yeah.
They're going to say 14 was in the area. He was in the acreage, but he wasn't in the area.
Yeah, in the area, he means he was in the field of play somewhere.
4:04 on the clock. It's fourth down and a yard for the Wolves. This has got to be Barnes time just to pick up a first down for Newberry. Harris quickly to the line of scrimmage. He's going to just follow Barnes into the hole, and he's going to be stopped, and the Pioneers are going to get a hold. Ivan Hogan's Colton Strickland with the biggest defensive play to the point of this game.
Huge play for the defense right there. Newberry only needed a yard to continue his drive, continue his push toward the end zone. Pioneer defense stayed at home, charged through, and got the stop.
Nobody in the acreage. Nobody in the area. On the previous play, by the way, we were getting another look at it. That's sometimes things happen for a reason, I guess. 3:58 to play in the contest. The Pioneers have it back. They get a stop on Newberry on fourth and a yard. Let's see if the Pioneers can hang on to it now. It'll be Jordan Shippey who will be the new running back. He's playing a bit hurt. Ogle is under center. Pioneers with maximum protection. They turn around and hand it off, and it doesn't matter. They're still beating the front. That's Jamarcus Henderson, who makes the big play behind the line, just adding to his career totals of tackles behind the line of scrimmage.
Well, I mean, in this situation, not what you wanted. You want 40 yardage every time, obviously. But right now, we're right about 3.5 minutes to play, and the Pioneers can eat up a bunch of time. Just keep the ball moving.
Randy Hooks has had a career day, 10 tackles defensively. Ivan Hoge is now up to 7 on the day. So second down and 14, loss of 4. Our total yardage goes back under 300 yards on this game. It's been a defensive struggle. Another handoff. This will be Shippey, and Shippey can't break the tackle behind the line. He'll make it up to the 46-yard line. Folks, it's been ugly. There's been some big plays in the game. It's just that the Pioneers have had the bigger plays than Newberry.
Well, big plays at the right time, both offensively and defensively for Tusculum.
Pioneers were backed up on their 1-yard line. Jordan Shippey broke the daylight, a 58-yard run, found himself open. So this Pioneer offense is still under 300 yards, and Newberry's priding themselves in holding the opposition to 100 yards under their season average. Right now, the Pioneers about 70 yards under their season average in total offense. But they have the 14-0 lead and the ball. With 2.5 to play, Ogle, a quick slant, and a nice defensive play once again by Vereen. Been very impressed with him. And it's fourth down and 11 with the ball intended for Aaron Fudge.
Yeah, but unfortunately, that stops the clock with 2:27. They got 30 seconds on the play clock, but it's not really going to help them because the clock is stopped as the punt unit comes home.
So it will be Cantrell to come on and punt it again. Just 2 weeks ago, he set a tie to school record with 11 punts. This is going to be his 10th. It'll be the 21st punt of the game. Cantrell to punt it away. They came after him, and he tried to sell it. He didn't get hit. And this ball will be touched up at the 31. Didn't get all of that one either. And had been a little bit slow in the delivery because Newberry had not come after him. But that time they did, Christian Bell touches it up at the 31. First and 10 for Newberry from there.
2 minutes, 20 seconds left in this game.
14-0 Tusculum. Next week, Newberry will be at home. They take on, or pardon me, on the road. They go to, well, they stay in the state. They go to Limestone and Gaffney and take on the Limestone Saints. The Pioneers travel to North Carolina. Pioneers in conference play all of their road games in the state of North Carolina for conference games, non-conference in the state of Georgia and Virginia this year. This will be Harris to pass. The real screen is too high and incomplete, intended for Cartez Cook, and it will bring up second down and 10 for the Wolves with the clock stop, 2:15 left.
Well, I certainly hope our trip on I-40 next Saturday was much better than mine on Wednesday.
And yeah, how'd that go?
It took me 8 hours to make a 6-hour drive because twice we were in complete standstills over right around McDowell County and coming up over there between Old Fort and Black Mountain for Rex.
Was it heavy rain and Rex?
It was Rex. The rain wasn't terribly heavy, but it was constant.
Second down and 10. This is going to be Harris for Newberry. Plenty of time, and he throws behind his intended target. There is a penalty flag. It took forever for Harris to get rid of it, and it was in the backfield for Tusculum. Ashton Watson, and I think he was tackled, and they finally got this one.
Yeah, they got the hole whenever they're standing in front. You can see the front of your jersey come down.
Penalties have absolutely killed Newberry today. That will be their 13th penalty. For 115 yards, 21 penalties total in the game. It's just been a team effort today for the Pioneer defense. It's not one guy. It's not been one individual. Offensively, it's not been one guy. It's a total team effort here today.
It really has, and most of your big plays have been by more than one person on that play.
Second down and 20, Harris will step up in the pocket, deliver the pass complete, and that's going to be Alford, who comes off his man to make the play at the 29-yard line. D has had a good game for sure for the Pioneers.
Gave up a few yards there, most importantly, kept him in bounds. We're down under 2 minutes remaining.
So third down and 12 coming up for the Newberry Wolves. A minute 40 and counting in this one. And Harris, who's gone the entire way the second half. Greg Ruff, along with Nick Jones, split time in the first half. Neither was effective. And not that Dre Harris has been very effective here in the second. It's just that he's been man, basically. Here, a wide-open Markel Castle complete at the 45-yard line. And Newberry trying to go quickly down 14 to nothing. Move the chains, first and 10.
Newberry up on the ball, ready to go as soon as things get set and the officials let them play.
Yeah, when they go quick, though, this is kind of where they get into some trouble with some penalties. First down and 10. Harris gets the snap. They blitz him. He's backing up. He's just going to loft it downfield. It's thrown up for grabs, and Malik Goodman mistimes his jump, staring right back into the setting sun here at Pioneer Field, and basically just missed the ball. It hit him in the hands.
Yeah, well, you had the Newberry wide receiver and then two of the Pioneers, all three kind of going up for it. So it was a jump ball, but unfortunately nobody came down with it, at least nobody in orange.
Second down and 10 for the Newberry Wolves with a minute 5 to play, and the Pioneers in this series that has been all tied up are a minute 5 away from taking the lead in the series, 11-10, knotted at 10 by getting their second consecutive win. Harris rolling the pocket, picked off. 45, 50, on his feet, 45, 40, 35, 30. David Johnson, second consecutive week with an interception, and he tried to return that one to the house, and the Tusculum Pioneers have the ball back and less than a minute to play.
Great job by the Pioneer defense, and it's fitting that perhaps the capper to this football game came on a defensive play.
David Johnson, how many balls had the Pioneers had their hands on in that first half that they just couldn't gather it? And David Johnson jumps the route, takes it to the 30-yard line of Newberry, and the Pioneers have it first and 10 with 52 seconds to play.
Here's the situation. What do we see? Does Newberry understand that time is not on their side and just let the game run out, or do they continue to try to stop the clock?
I think so. What Jerry Odom's going to check out here. He's just going to see if they call a timeout after the play, and if they do, I guarantee you he takes a knee, but I'm not sure that they would even have to snap it again. And the Newberry Wolves run blitz and get the stop, and they're not going to do it. They're going to let the clock run. Newberry's not going to stop it down two scores. And so they'll have to snap it one more time. Jamarcus Henderson has to get his...
There's about 5 seconds difference between the play clock and the game clock.
Shippey is hurt again as he comes off the field. This will be big going into next week. What running backs do we have healthy? Pratt not healthy. Shippey not 100%. Maxwell Joseph's fumbling it every play, and Maurice Gamillion is also fumbling it. Ogle will go into the victory formation. 3 seconds to snap it. 2 seconds. 1 second. Snap it. Snap it. Oh, my goodness. Do they not see it?
Well, the play clock is in the shade, so I don't really know why you couldn't see that.
Penalty. Jerry Odom is going to get his second win against the Newberry Wolves. Newberry 2 years ago came here and beat Tusculum en route to their conference championship winning year, 37-10. Last year, Tusculum down 14-3, rally, win in two overtimes by going for two by a final of 32-31. The Pioneers shut out the Wolves, and that's big in that case.
The last time Newberry was shut out, 128 games ago, they lost 10-0 to Presbyterian on November 10th, 2006.
It snaps the four-game losing streak during the month. For the Wolves, it snaps their three-game winning streak inside the state of Tennessee. And it also snaps this decade of success for Newberry, where they had won 6 of 8 meetings this decade. The Pioneers have now won back-to-back for the first time, really since, what, the 2007, maybe 2008 season against the Newberry Wolves. 8-9. So their first winning streak over Newberry. So a big one today. The sons of Davy Crockett give the homecoming crowd a nice little gift and a 14-0 win. The Pioneers get the shutout in this contest. Newberry hadn't been shut out in a long time. And it's not as if there was any one single person. Today's win was a total team effort by the Pioneers.
It truly was. Both sides of the football, defense especially, but just a great job by these guys to come out here and win on homecoming in front of this big crowd.
Pioneers get the victory, and they knock off Newberry. They stay a game back of Lenoir Rhyne in the South Atlantic Conference standings as well in that loss column, as LR has remained unbeaten. Carson Newman also winning to stay just one game back. Now Newberry with two losses and no one else with a winning record in the league outside of LR, Carson Newman, and Tusculum. So the Pioneers improve to 4-2, go to 3-1 in the league, and next week travel to Catawba. We'll talk about that and a little bit more as our Pioneer postgame report will begin. It is homecoming, and we'll chat with Pioneer coach Jerry Odom in our Pioneer postgame. Again, your final score, Tusculum 14 and Newberry 0. Thanks for listening to Pioneer Football. Now stay tuned to our Pioneer postgame report here.